And welcome to episode 22 of Tomorrow's World Audit Time. Afternoon, Mark.
Afternoon, Russ. How are you?
Not bad, not bad, Mark. I was just thinking, you've been on quite a long holiday recently, haven't you, to America? I'm sure you enjoyed yourself.
I have, yes.
And I don't know, have you been keeping up with the news at all? Because quite a few things have happened since we last recorded this show. And I don't know whether you've just been keeping abreast with things at all.
No, I've just been catching up on all the EastEnders episodes on this, obviously.
Well, I don't know. It seems like probably Britain is finally going completely down the pan. I mean, it's an absolute dumpster fire of everything going wrong, isn't it, Mark?
All change. It's what a time to be alive, etc. Aren't we all blessed to live in these times, you know, so on and so forth. I was thinking, because I said to you in the message, it's like, I have a six-year-old niece, and so far she has lived through four different prime ministers. I was 26 when my fourth prime minister started serving, so I think that's got to be a good thing, isn't it? You know, variety is the spice of life.
Absolutely, yeah.
So they're like Pokemon, aren't they? They're Pokemon. You got to catch them all.
One of the great things about eras of political upheaval, Mark, I think we're re-entering a golden age of strike action, you know, and
yes indeed, yeah.
It's just fun to see, isn't it? I always like a bit of industrial action, some protest people. I mean, yesterday we had somebody chucking soup over a Van Gogh, didn't we?
Or over the glass over a Van Gogh, yeah. And I was just thinking, actually, to be fair, like, they're way ahead of us as well, these strikers, because frankly we'll all want to be huddling around a briar this coming winter, won't we?
So in sort of solidarity with our protesting and striking chums, we decided to pick an episode which I came across it completely accident, and all it said in the description of the episode was, due to industrial action, a compilation of previously transmitted items was shown. So this is basically an episode of Tomorrow's World that has been cobbled together from spare parts from previous episodes of Tomorrow's World. So there's no studio parts, and there's nothing new in this. But I mean, because there's so few 70s episodes available. Oh yeah, I thought I said the date, have I? This is from the 29th. The 29th of November, 1979. Yeah, so they've cobbled it together from previous episodes from a couple of years behind.
Before, well, I mean, you say cobbled together, Russ. I think they took a long time. Like they had a, you know, like a loop over their eye, looking at all the gems available to them, and they managed to share this with us.
Well, there's some astonishing choices in this, because there's some of the VTs that they're using here that just don't go anywhere, do they?
There's definitely, the first time I saw this, there was a couple of times where I laughed out loud, because I recognised that I was sitting there waiting for them to explain why they were showing us something. And nope, next item. And it's just like, you know, I don't know what the Tomorrow's World all the time equivalent of blue balls are, Russ, but sometimes I was definitely left hanging for...
So I thought, oh, well, what is the industrial action that has caused Judith and Michael and everybody else to hang up their aprons for a week? And I could not find what it was at all. I looked for all the various strike action that it could be around November 1979, and I could not find any specific mention of anything that would have affected the BBC at all. So I don't actually know what this refers to. But obviously, in 1979, the previous winter, we've had the winter of discontent, and then this year, there's strikes happening willy-nilly all around the place. So I guess that maybe there were so many strikes some of them just slipped through the cracks, and people didn't even pay heed to what they were about or even make a note of them. But what I did find, though, is that reasonably relevant to this, there was a very famous big TV strike, but it only affected ITV, and that has only just ended the previous month. So it started on the 6th of August. So on the 6th of August, the electricians at Thames Television, they were upset about a pay rise offer they got, so they walked out. And then, was it 3 days later? So on the 10th of August, basically everyone at ITV, in solidarity, just all walked out. So ITV just went blank on that day. The negotiations took 11 weeks to come to an agreement. So that meant that ITV went dark for 11 weeks until October the 24th, right? But obviously, we're in a period now where there's only three. There's only BBC One, BBC Two, and ITV. There's no Channel Four, and there's nothing else. So that meant that the BBC totally dominated the airwaves for 11 weeks with no competition whatsoever. Which means probably some of the preceding episodes of Tomorrow's World to this probably had the highest viewership of any episodes of Tomorrow's World there ever has been. because there's literally nothing else to watch. But what this meant, though, was that the BBC got viewerships that were absolutely through the roof for even like quite mundane things. Everything was getting 15 to 20 million viewers. The absolute tip-top pinnacle of it was the final episode of the first series of To the Manor Born, starring Penny Keith, as Maggie Philbin likes to call her. Yeah. That got 23.95 million viewers.
Wow. That must be about half the country, I assume.
Yeah. To this day, makes it the ninth most watched TV programme in UK history.
That is amazing.
Sandwiched between Miss World 1967 and January 1988 episode of EastEnders, where Angie Watts suffered kidney failure. Sure. It's got slightly more viewers. But this cost ITV an estimated £100 million in lost advertising revenue when it was went dark.
Wow. In 1979.
Yeah. Amazing. Yeah. And the only thing, if you turned on ITV at the time, the only thing that you would see is just a message, like literally a message saying that ITV is off the air at the moment. But then they replaced that temporarily. West Yorkshire Police said, can we use this? So they replaced it with an appeal to try and help catch the Yorkshire Ripper. So,
wow,
so, yeah.
It's amazing.
So that, you know, that sort of, you know,
that worked. Well done, guys. You got them.
Yeah, exactly. It took 11 weeks for them to come to an agreement. But by the when they did come to an agreement, I've got to say the strikers absolutely took ITV to the cleaners, because they ended up getting a 45% pay rise.
Wow.
So their salary shot up from £8,000 a year to £11,620 a year. Good job, lads. That's something to encourage. Ooh. Encourage our...
And we should bear that number in mind for when we're talking about prices. Let's yes. find out how much how many striking electricians can buy this year.
How many kettles they can buy.
How many kettles.
Yeah. But
well, they're electricians, Russ. I'm
so sure. I don't know. I was thinking maybe... obviously, the strike has ended by now, but I was wondering whether there's some sort of knock-on effect from this strike that has somehow affected the BBC. I don't know whether everyone was too busy helping the ITV people get started up, or I don't know. I just wondered whether there was, because they're so close together. I just wondered whether there was any connection between the two, but I could not determine what it was.
I don't know. It's interesting nonetheless. Seems likely, doesn't it?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But also, I managed to find, so obviously when ITV came back, they wanted to, on the 24th of October, they obviously wanted to come back with a bit of razzmatazz. So I'm going to show you this now, Mark. Luckily, lots of people recorded this, so it's easily to find on YouTube. They recorded a special welcome home startup sequence.
Ooh, okay.
So this is worth a...
Let me just embiggen this.
Good evening. It's nice to be back. In a moment, the news at 5:45, followed by the Muppets with Dudley Moore at 6:05. At 6:35, Crossroads, and at 7, it's George and Mildred.
I'm winning, Mildred.
What are you doing?
I'm playing with myself.
7:30 for Coronation Street. At 8, Ted Rogers presents 3-2-1, and at 9, John Mills is Professor Quatermass.
It happened here. The same thing. It was here too.
After the news, Chinatown at 10:30 stars Jack Nicholson and John Huston.
You're dealing with a disturbed woman who's just lost her husband.
Faye Dunaway at the center of an intriguing mystery at 10:30. The Muppets, Crossroads, George and Mildred, Coronation Street, 3-2-1, Quatermass, Chinatown. Tonight's Welcome Home from ITV.
Brilliant.
That's good stuff, isn't it, Mark?
Oh my gosh. Welcome home to ITV. Does that make sense grammatically or in terms of like the spirit? Like, it's not welcome back to ITV or welcome to your home, ITV. It's welcome home to ITV.
Yeah.
I don't know. Brilliant. That's fabulous. The one question, as you were talking about the strike and ITV being off for 11 weeks, the one question in my head was like, I hope Russell will tell me what was the first show back on that they brought. Like, that's a big statement show.
Yeah.
And whatever it is, the first time that channel's broadcast, and I'm okay with the news, but the fact that it's the Muppets with Dudley Moore, that's brilliant. And then George and Mildred, who's playing with himself. That's fabulous.
You've got to come back with a bet. You've got to try and poach those BBC viewers back, haven't you? You've got to come back with it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Get out your absolute big guns. George and Mildred,
your big gun, and, you know,
3-2-1.
BBC viewers love wanking jokes. Fact.
But yeah, but I was surprised Chinatown, because I thought Chinatown, when did that come out? I would have thought that came 76? Out fairly recently, but because it always seemed like back then it took a long time for a film to go from the cinema to the TV. But
literally years, yeah.
I was surprised by that. But
great film. Yeah. I only watched it recently, last couple of years during lockdown. Really, really good. And as always a reminder, it's like, I would imagine that that film has probably been not seen by the vast majority of the population. B, no one really has VHSs, so you had to be sat there at 10:30 to watch Chinatown. Yeah, amazing.
Yeah.
Well, welcome home to ITV. What a great tune. Not dated at all.
Can I tell you something about that tune, Mark? That's
please,
that's performed by performed by the Mike Sams Singers.
Ooh.
I'd not heard of the Mike Sams Singers, but they're quite an illustrious. So they're basically I don't know what you call them. They did a lot of tunes for TV in that sort of chorus style. I would say their biggest hitting theme tune that we know is the theme tune to Stingray, Mark.
Ooh.
They did that, but also provided backing vocals on a lot of pop hits, especially in the 60s. And they did the backing vocals on Tom Jones's Delilah and Green Green Grass, Helen Shapiro's Walking Back to Happiness. And I think probably the peak of their fame came when they did the noises in the background to the Beatles' I Am the Walrus. So all of the woo, all that malarkey, that's the Mike Sam Singers.
Wow. I assume it's probably not the Singers that we've heard just now. I assume that they're probably an ever-changing group. But that's pretty... Well done, Mike Sams.
Yeah.
That's impressive. That is impressive. Yeah, Stingray, I Am a Walrus, and Welcome Home to ITV.
It's a bit of an earworm, though. I've still got Welcome Home to...
Yeah, no, I can still hear it, annoyingly, yeah. Welcome Home to ITV. I mean, I don't watch it.
I can't remember the last time I watched anything on ITV.
They in the defense, they have definitely had a good couple of dramas recently. Oh, the one, the Dennis Nielsen thing with David Tennant was very good.
Oh, yeah.
But I could not tell you when that was. I'm assuming the last 2 years.
Anyway, should we try it? Let's banish that earworm with our own proper BBC earworm,
please.
Shall we?
Altogether a more middle class earworm.
Oh, Mark, I haven't eaten any lunch today, so I have to say, that title sequence, which we've not seen before, maybe it's kind of slightly peckish there.
Well, I mean, it's what time is it? It's 3:15 in Amsterdam as we record, so, I mean, you must be up 20 minutes now. You're probably easily thinking about breakfast.
Yeah, definitely. Well, certainly, yeah, once I saw that sizzling bacon and eggs and...
We've not seen this credit before, so obviously everyone's really excited that I'm going to describe it. This is the foodiest opening credits I think I've seen of any program since The Food Show or the original Master Chef. Food and Drink, that was it, yeah. Food and Drink. I was thinking of the Money program. For some reason, I couldn't get that name out of my head. They were the same thing, weren't they?
What
a fascinating opening credits that is basically breakfast themed. It is so weird. I really feel like, because I was looking back at the previous opening credits that we've discussed, and we must be very close to the point where, so obviously Raymond Bax is not part of this, the old crew are not part of this. This is very much like the second generation presenters have properly taken over. I think we must be very, very close to the point where we move into the next theme tune. We must be really close because they have clearly run out of ideas for opening credits to keep it fresh. Shall I describe it to you and the listeners? So the way this one works is that we see the word Tomorrow's World initially. We've had this before where it basically Tomorrow's World is all glittery and then explodes, and you learn that obviously it has been glitter the whole time. It just explodes at the screen. And then from that point on, the word Tomorrow's, but not World, is then spelled out in its own little segment. And each letter is spelled out in a different way. So the T is dough. That seems to be proving.
Yeah, it's almost like a slice.
And it's in reverse.
It's almost like a slice of bread, isn't it? It's like that slice of bread shape, but it's a whole... Yeah.
But it expands, except that they show it in reverse, so it actually shrinks to make the T. Yeah. We see O, and again, played in reverse, the shape is formed by fallen nails rewriting themselves. As in, you know, you hammer them into the wall as opposed to, you know, horrible shavings from people's fingers. The letter M emerges from a liquid, which I'm hoping is water, but I have very serious concerns that this is a mercury-themed episode, or certainly a mercury-flavoured episode. O, the second... The second O, the camera zooms into a frying pan. Around the edge of the frying pan, there are three delicious rashers of bacon frying, and right in the middle is a lovely round egg with a rectangular yolk, which I've never seen in my life before.
Mouth-watering, Mark. Mouth-watering.
Delicious. The first letter R, again, in reverse, we see hundreds of ball bearings coming together to form that letter. The second letter R, it's a cut-through. It's a hole in a sheet metal, and behind it, flames appear, which really reminded me of the opening credits of the World
at War. Yeah, you're bang on there. That really is, very similar. Yeah.
The third O is some kind of metal, some kind of object melting, again, shown in reverse, so it's reforming, but it didn't look like ice. I fear, once again, that's some kind of...
dangerous chemical.
Mercury, yes, or dangerous metal that, you know, one of those wonderful metals that melts at, you know, room temperature.
T-1000.
The letter W is, we had the dough proving. This time the dough bakes and crispens. Mm. Actually looks quite good. And then finally the S, once again, we see this in reverse. It is hundreds of white pills coming together to make the letter, the shape of the S. Bizarrely, and I don't know why, there is one pink pill in that pile, and it is absolutely not in the middle of the letter. It's in the middle of the row, but not in the middle of the letter, which I find quite infuriating. And then to end on, the word Tomorrow's World is made by, this time, thousands of ball bearings coming together, i.e. in reverse, to show the iconic title card that we all know and love. And I should also say, there is some kind of weird wash over the name coming together, which, again, I fear seems to be flowing torrents of mercury that they're just... no safety whatsoever. It is, it's weird. Like, it just seems like it's half mercury, half breakfast.
I was just thinking, I've got this mental image now of somebody with like a fryer, and instead of like a splodge of tomato ketchup on the corner of the plate, they just got a splodge of mercury, and they're just dipping their, bacon and eggs in it and eating it.
That's what we'll have to. We just have to text Jeremy Piven and see if he can shine a light on this. He claimed it was sushi, didn't he? I think we know what he was up to. So that's it. That's our latest new credits to describe us. It's a weird one. Like, I really just feel like they're... don't get me wrong. There was definitely times I was looking at it and I was hungry. If that's what they were going for, they absolutely nailed it.
It is a theme that they occasionally go to, is the idea of spelling out Tomorrow's World with the titles. But I don't think it is, unless we've been massively missing something, they don't do it on every title sequence, do they? It's not like there's, it's been...
No, not at all.
Because I just imagine that actually some of the more strange title sequences we've been seeing, it turns out that it's a secret code, and actually it is spelling out Tomorrow's World in like abstract objects or something like that. I don't know.
Gosh, now you're making me go back to have a look again, which obviously is something I'm desperate to do. I did look at the ones around this era, and I did not see anyone spelling out the letters in code or in reality. Yeah, okay. So
good.
Might need a closer look.
All right, nice. That's the titles then. Well, talking about fitting things together from abstract parts, should we move on to the first segment?
Yes.
Thank you.
Cambridge is a city with which I'm not familiar, but there is someone here, someone I don't know, looking for me. Now, the chances are I'm only going to get a fleeting glimpse of him. Of course, it could be a her. And then we're going to see how much I can remember of what his face looks like. Then we're going to demonstrate how much technology can help in that process.
Is it him? Could it be him? Or him? Ah, it's not a man, it's a girl. It's difficult to know what it is I am looking for.
Hello, Michael.
To try and remember a new face, it helps to start with a face you're familiar with. Not yours. Ah, this is a better one.
Here is a system which can remember millions of faces. The computer driving this video display can call up from its memory elements of all the faces that have ever been fed into it. And I can use those elements to build up on the screen a representation of that mysterious man on the bike. Now, it seems that people involved in short encounters, the victims of muggings and attacks, recollect, surprisingly perhaps, the hairline of their attacker most vividly. So, using this electronic drawing board, let's pick out a few alternative hairlines. Now, that one's too hairy altogether. Another one. Yes, that's better. Let's put that one on our composite. Yes, it's right, but the wrong colour. Try it lighter. That's much better. We'll buy that. Now, let's move on to the eyes. Of course, there's no way that I could describe to you the eyes of the man on the bicycle. But the theory goes that with this sort of stimulation, my memory might actually be able to recall details I didn't know I'd picked up in the first place. Up come some eyes. I can't tell you why, but I think number 5 are the right ones. Excellent. This is the computer-aided design center. And this system is a prototype one being developed for the Home Office. It is at the moment very much in its early days. But there is already evidence that the computer's ability to mix and blend all the elements that make up a human face in an ever-changing and realistic composite could be a great help to a witness desperately trying to remember what a complete stranger looked like. Certainly, having used this system to activate my memory, I'm now confident enough to face an identity parade and try and pick out the mystery man on the bike.
Now, this episode is bookended by Rod. And I've got to say, he's certainly the MVP of this episode, because I would say that by quite a margin, the beginning and end segments of this episode are by far the best. And I would say that this is actually the best segment.
Yes.
There is so much in it to talk about. It's absolutely packed, as you said, packed with content.
Yeah, and that's just the first 30 seconds. I don't know how many lines, sentences I was writing. I think it took me about 20 minutes to write out my thoughts from the first 30 seconds of this entire episode, because every line and image was just amazing. Just an incredible choice. Can we start at the start, though? Yeah. Like, because you'll have heard the classic zither tune from the theme tune from The Third Man, which is a film I like very much, Russ, but I don't think is one you've seen.
I haven't seen it. No, obviously it's one of those films that's
very good.
It's in the collective consciousness so much that I know a lot about it, but I've never actually sat down and watched it.
It's really good. I think, you know, genuinely really, it was one of those ones where, like, when I kind of hit my 20s, it was like, I remember going to Virgin with, like, my student loan check and buying, like, they used to have, like, you know, you could get, like, 3 VHS tapes for 20 or 3 DVDs.
What a waste of my student loan.
Yeah, I know, but at the same time, like, I bought loads of films that I would go on to really love, and one of them that I played a lot was The Third Man. So I love that tune whenever I hear it. But married to it is this wonderful sequence of images of, it starts off with Judith Hann, doesn't it? And you see her face as a photo of it. It's actually her picture. And then slowly the elements change and we see Kieran Prendiville, and then slowly, Prendiville, on the beat, you know, another element changes and it becomes Michael Rod. What's brilliant is that Kieran looks amazing whether he has his own hair, Michael Rod's hair, or Judith Hann's hair. He looks like an absolute legend in all of them. It's just, it's a wonderful sequence because, like, it's like the old Hue and Cry and Black and White, those videos where, like, they changed the shape of people and, you know, like, and it blew people's minds in the 90s. Tomorrow's World was doing that a decade and a half before, my friend, with cutting edge technology here. It's just, it's a really brilliant, I really loved watching it over and over again. I thought it was really, really cool.
We got Rod, then we cut to Rod in Cambridge, a city with which he's not familiar. Mark.
I struggle to believe he's not throwing vicious shade. as I said to you, is this his way of conveying some kind of resentment? Because he must be surrounded by multitudes of Oxbridge grads, and I immediately pictured him in the BBC canteen sitting at a table on his own while they all guffawed up and their big cliques.
Yeah, and then he reveals to us that someone is looking for him.
Yes,
it's never explained why someone is looking for him, is it?
No, I mean, obviously we know why, which is so he can do this experiment, but at no point does he say so. It actually at moments it sounds quite threatening, and he does sound a bit trepidatious.
And obviously, so everyone's a suspect now. So we get...
Everyone's a suspect, yes.
We get some close-ups of the locals. I always wonder, I bet in 1979 they didn't bother... I very much doubt they'd bother getting
clearance?
People to sign off clearance on anything like that. So these people were probably just as surprised as us to see themselves on TV.
And God knows they were definitely watching because there was nothing else on.
No, exactly, yeah. Some real...
Can we just say...
I was going to say some real characters.
Before we talk about the characters, can we just dig a little bit into what Michael says? Because he does not explain what this is for. Like, we'll get there. Obviously, it becomes self-evident. And actually, the little montage with the photo fit pictures at the beginning, which is just a lovely little bit of business, is nice. As you rightly said, he says, but there is someone here, someone I don't know, looking for me. Now, the chances are I'm only going to get a fleeting glimpse of him. Of course, it could be a her. Which, first chuckle line, because God knows, we know it's not going to be a her. Indeed, he himself admits that. He admits that himself a second later when he goes, and then we're going to see how much I can remember what his face looks like. Nice one, Rod. We knew it was a joke. Then he starts talking about these wonderful characters. I made a little list of the ones who really jumped out at me. And by all means, Ross, you can give them your own. You tell me what you thought of them as well. I thought one of them looked like a holidaying Harold Shipman.
Yeah.
I thought he's down from Manchester for the weekend, enjoying the delights of Cambridge. One of them was Her Late Majesty Queen Elizabeth II.
That haircut, I cannot believe how close to the Queen's haircut hers was. It was.
Yeah.
She must have gone.
The Queen had their haircut, wasn't it?
Maybe. But it's like she's walked into a salon and gone, I want exact, like, just held up like a £10 note and gone, I want that, please.
Yeah, but from now, though. Yeah. Not from there. Like, the Queen back then was only 40-something.
Yeah.
There was Jacques Cousteau's cooler uncle. I don't know why. He had this magic pipe and he had that fabulous kind of French beard.
There was definitely maritime about him, wasn't there? Definitely.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah, in the famously landlocked Cambridge. And then there was a guy who reminded me of a Soviet spy trying to fit in.
Yeah.
Because he had the proper kind of Russian hat on. And it looked like a nice spring day. It should not have been.
No. And he did look fairly Slavic as well. I think he probably might well have been some sort of Russian.
Initially, he reminded me of one of the characters in The Ipcress File and The Brilliant Dollar Brain. Mm. But then actually I realised he looked like his traitorous boss in those films, who I suppose kind of was a Russian spy. But now that's when I started losing the train and thinking, like, I don't even know who I'm thinking about anymore. There's just too much to think about in this episode. And then, of course, he comes to the wonderful line. So he goes, is it him? It could be him. How about him? And then he says... Ah, it's not a man, it's a girl. Which I thought was just wonderful. Men are men, girls are girls.
As soon as you said that, I thought, it's not a girl, Rod, it's not a girl. And sure enough, but even in his own segment, Rod makes himself look like a loser. Because
he looked like the third man.
Yeah.
Even though the third man is central to the plot of that film, even in Michael Rudd's Third Man pastiche, the third man has nothing to do with anything. God bless him. But yeah, it's definitely not a girl. And so this kind of woman who is a woman, not a girl, runs up in a cloak and she kind of grabs the arm of this really old looking man who turns, and I have not seen a happier, more chuffed chap on television for a very long time.
Yeah.
He is quite delighted with whatever's happening there.
While Rod stands there looking like a bit of a mug, thinking it was him.
A bit of a mug, it was him that
she was running towards. And then is it now that we cut to Rod standing outside a branch of Interflora? I think it is, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Contemplating a gnome.
And then. Yeah, that is the most surreal part of it, I think, is that Rod is seriously, he's got an orange gnome in his hand, quite a decent sized garden gnome, and he's just kind of why is he contemplating? Does he think, what's going on?
I don't know, Russell, I don't know. But our chap arrives, though.
Yes, yeah.
While his back is turned to the road for the first time. His eyes have been peeled the whole time. And just the one time he looks away to examine a gnome, the guy comes by. The stranger.
Yeah. I think what they're trying to represent here, they're trying to represent the idea that you only get to see somebody very fleetingly. So they try to represent that using special effects.
Camera trickery. I don't know what they're doing.
So it's brilliant, isn't it? They apply an echo sound which I suppose that is how like memory in film, memory is quite often represented by echoing, isn't it?
Flashbacks and kind of when people replay lines that they've heard or whatever, it's kind of has a kind of an echoey distant feel.
So I guess that's what they're trying to do there.
It's not bad.
No.
It's not bad. Because the guy comes by in a bike. We'll talk about him later. But the guy comes by in a bike. And I think, doesn't he say, hello, Michael?
Yeah,
and just waves at him.
Yeah.
And then cycles off with alacrity round the corner. Obviously, Michael doesn't think about running after him. Because of course not.
or throwing the gnome at him to knock him off his bike.
Throwing the gnome at him. So we have this moment where like Michael is obviously seeing this guy in freeze frame. So we see these four images as the camera zooms in. And even though you see them only for a fleeting second, it becomes very clear and obvious that this is not a still image that they're zooming in on. They've asked this guy in the bike to stand still while they move the camera closer to him on three different occasions. Because right at the end, it's a big close-up in his face. And it's just the hair. The hair is just blowing on his forehead because he's trying to stand stock still to pretend it's a freeze frame. It's brilliant. I loved it. I loved it so much.
It's got to be one of the most abstract sort of sequences of events we've seen.
It was Reeves and Mortimer-esque, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. It really was, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the music really suited it as well. Before we get to the actual invention in hand, shall I just give you some little information about the Third Man theme?
Oh, yeah, please.
So the Third Man theme is by an Austrian zither player, unsurprisingly, and composer called Anton Karas. It's quite a nice story, actually. So what was happening was that Carol Reed, the director of The Third Man, they were filming, obviously him and Orson Welles and all the rest of the cast. And after a long day's filming in Vienna, they retired to a wine cellar. And at that point, Carol Reed hadn't really decided what music was going to go on the film. And then they just heard that. So this Anton fella was just busking in, well, not busking exactly, but not just playing for tips in the wine cellar. And Carol Reed just suddenly went, oh, this is perfect. This is exactly what we need for the film. So he just went over to him, had to get somebody to translate into German for him because nobody could speak German. And he said, look, come back to England and we'll like record the soundtrack. But Anton was a little bit reluctant because he fought for the Germans in the Second World War. So
I didn't know that.
Yeah. So he was a bit scared about coming back to England. So Carol Reed had to kind of convince him. In the end, he did. So he went back and recorded this at Shepperton Studios. And it became an absolutely massive international smash hit record. Obviously, back then there wasn't really any pop music, so this is the closest thing to pop music that you might have got at the time. But they sold more than half a million copies within a couple of weeks of the film's release. It spent, and this obviously, the US Billboard charts had only just started around this time, and it spent 11 weeks at number one in the US Billboard charts. So it's right up there with, wet, wet, wet equivalent. But yeah, and so this was in 1950, just after the film came out. And in that same year, four other cover versions of the song were released. And wow. And they also all charted on the Billboard chart. So it was just Gosh. It was just third man, wall-to-wall third man theme playing everywhere. And they reckon that if you put add together all of the different versions of it sold since then, the record has sold a total of 40 million copies.
Wow.
So yeah, it's an absolutely mega blockbuster.
I didn't know that. I knew it was big, but yeah, because I just think it's a brilliant shoot. I like the film, so I just think it's brilliant. And it's gosh, I hope he saw money from all those versions as well.
Well, he did. I mean, he was initially quite reluctant to play it because it was a composition that he'd had in his mind. He'd occasionally played it for like 15 years before he even met Carol Reed. But he said, there's a quote from him. He said he didn't like playing it. Because when you play in a cafe, nobody stops to listen. This tune takes a lot out of your fingers. I prefer playing VN VN, which is like some other song that he composed. Mm-hmm. The sort of thing one can play all night while eating sausages at the same time. So he was a slightly reluctant star, but after obviously this big blockbuster, he embarked on loads of world tours. He like completely changed his life. And he met all sorts of different celebrities and royalty, including Princess Margaret, Queen Juliana of the Netherlands, the Pope, and Emperor Hirohito. He played audiences for all of those. And he sparked a huge surge in zither sales. So really, 1950 really was the year.
So now
the
we
year
know
of
why,
the zither.
Yeah, I bet say that's why, you know, living in Hackney, I'm surrounded by zither players, all because of this song.
Probably is due another comeback, that's actually, fantastic. Isn't it? You know, it's quite a hipster sounding instrument, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
God knows how many adverts it must have been on, because it's just one of those songs you hear all the time, like just around and about. You can never quite place where you've heard it.
Third man.
Yeah. But yeah, so on to the actual invention itself. So we've got Rod, and he's in the Computer Aided Design Centre.
That's right.
Which was a big thing in Cambridge at the time. And he's got, I think what he's playing with here does not look at all dissimilar to what we're used to as seeing as like sort of the photo fits that we see on Crime Watch or whatever, is it? It seems like a pretty similar setup that he's got there.
Yeah, it did. There are some hideous lies, I was about to say shallowly buried in this bit later on. But like I did feel like, because he said that, doesn't he say this is a bit of a home office experiment and I think they might be onto something, so this is how it works.
Yeah.
It's like, I believe that bit of it, and I'm fascinated to find out whether this really is like the beginning of the e-photo fit process, because I think up until that point, like, you'd have a big ledger of books, wouldn't you? Like, you'd be pulling bits out and
it was chopped up physical photos before this.
On little tabs, and you know, you'd put them into the slot and there your eyes and so on and so forth. And this is obviously an electronic version of this, and I, by all means, Russ, describe exactly how he uses it, because it's very odd. But despite the hideous lies, which we will come to, I don't know, it felt pretty genuine. And even the idea of like, you start with the hairline, that's the bit that people remember most, like, ooh, that felt true to me. That was one of those things where I suppose like maybe I would start with the hair and you work down.
I mean,
because and again, his point about like you can't really describe your memory of someone.
No,
it's more that you could feel it and know it and see it, and this is a way of kind of just winkle picking this out of somebody.
I mean, top tip for anybody out there who wants to mug or attack anybody on the street: immediately change your hair, change your hairline as soon as you get home, and then you're absolutely home free. I think he's got a TV screen with digitized photographs on it. And he's able to select, obviously, the different hair, then different eyes and different mouth, different nose, all those things. But I was very intrigued by the machine that he was using to do this. Mm. And it obviously must be something that people who work in computer-aided design probably use in their job that's been adapted.
Yes.
It's been adapted to do this this job here.
He's on like a kind of an angle desk like you'd expect to see an architect use, you know, like if they were doing blueprints. And I can imagine how like an architect would like use this kind of weird mouse thing to kind of pick a point and the computer picks up where it is roughly in line with. That bit I didn't understand. Like, how does it know where the mouse is? But let's assume it does. And then, you know, I sort of point up in the top left corner, the computer knows where I am, and I drag it down. That kind of thing. But somebody has put in like hand-drawn menus, almost like early Windows. It's graph paper, isn't it? You know, the mathematics paper with the dots.
Yeah.
And somebody has drawn a little box and they've put in eyes, so he has to click on it. And then we don't see, the camera doesn't follow the mouse, but you see him, he goes up to another little tab. It's like Oh, actually, his hair, wasn't it? And then, like, there's another, he disappears off screen, and it must click, you know, must click on, like, light or dark, or because obviously it's not in colour, it's in black and white. It's very peculiar.
Yeah. I was quite interested.
I assume it's real.
I was quite interested in the idea.
I wanted to know more of that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Have they looked at that before? Because it's essentially it's a infinitely customizable interface that you can draw, with your hands. I'd like that now. So, yeah.
Yeah, very true.
It was weird that he was just kind of glossing over that.
Yeah.
But they probably have covered it before. And I guess it's probably something specifically designed for this computer-aided design lab, I would have thought. But it was interesting that they'd obviously just adapted it to this thing that could have easily have just been run with a normal keyboard on a computer. But the other thing I was thinking is that if they've got this big database of heads that they're obviously chopping up, how do they always ensure? Because everyone's, I mean, famously, I've got enormous cheeks, Mark. And so, sure, how would they ensure, if they were, for example, getting your thin head, how would they ensure that my enormous cheeks lined up with your thin head? I don't understand. How would that even work? Surely there'd just be like a big right angle gap where they don't line up. But it seems like they somehow line up on this all the time.
But maybe they deliberately scale it in such a way. So it's not like they use, like they would scale my face up a little bit more, maybe scale yours down a little bit so that they're all roughly in line with each other. What's that little kid's notebook which has three sections so that you can kind of, you know, draw, somebody draws a head and then somebody draws the body and somebody draws the legs all separately and then you put them together.
Yeah.
And usually there are big gaps, aren't there? The legs, somebody will have drawn little narrow, little tiny legs thinking that somebody's going to do a big, huge, fat body. Yeah, you're absolutely right. But maybe not here, but I assume down the line they've kind of just, they tweak it so that like you get an indicative sense of somebody's big, massive heaver style jowl. And everyone just look at the little podcast logo just to get a sense. I really did. And imagine that it's using the same technology they use in Lord of the Rings. So I'm actually much closer to the camera when I took this picture, whereas Russell's way back in the distance. That's the only way I could get our face at the same scale.
But now Rod's. Well, and this, I think then we need to get into the BBC Lies section. Because I think if you want to demonstrate how this technology works, you should be demonstrating what the situation would be in real life circumstances. So what Rod should be doing...
You think they should have mugged him?
Yeah. Should have mugged Rod. Rod should be using the existing database to create a closest representation of the person that he's looking for. Because that is what actually would happen in real life.
Can we talk about the person he's looking for first? Just because I think a little bit of context, because I'm going to refer to him as the stranger. The stranger they've picked has a powerfully unique face. I don't think I've ever seen anyone before or after him. And the weird thing is you can't tell how old he is.
He's quite a young
looking face, but a really old looking head and hairline. Mm. He's wearing a cravat. He looks like Matt Smith. And I was trying to think, Matt Smith playing who? And you rightly said, it's Matt Smith playing Julian Assange.
Yeah.
But it's the Julian Assange who's been trapped in the Ecuadorian embassy for 5 years.
Yeah, he's got wispy white hair, but with that very strong sort of
beady eyes,
strong Matt Smith chin.
Yeah, absolutely. And so, actually, as a starting point, he's almost perfect. Like he's the platonic ideal of somebody that Rod should be able to describe. But knowing that, dear listeners, knowing that, this is where it's a bit disappointing because
as soon as Rod goes through the people that he's got a list of five or six different
attributes or whatever variables. Yeah,
the fourth one down is clearly the eyes of the man that he's looking for.
Unmistakably, yeah, because not only are they clearly his eyes, but they are a completely different type of picture to the other parts of the e-photo segment.
It's like a much sharper image.
So basically, his entire photograph is in the system, and it's a completely different grade of photo, and it's it is dishearteningly clear and obvious exactly what they're up to.
Yeah, so Rod unsurprisingly picks that to create his photo fit.
He tries to cover his tracks. He tries to pretend otherwise later on, but because what does he say? Because when he compares his photo fit of the stranger with the stranger's photo, which, as we've just explained, is the same thing. And Rod chastises himself,
yeah,
Opus Dei-like, with a kind of a whipping his back, saying, "No, this is rotten. I've done bad." Yeah. It's like, no, you've literally rebuilt the photo they gave you.
Yeah, he calls it a rotten representation.
A rotten representation. It's not.
It's the same photo.
It's the same, but with lines on it. Oh, Michael.
This is the other interesting thing. So he's created the photo fit. But then he's given a police lineup. Well, obviously not a police lineup, but I think in policing they're two separate things, aren't they? They don't get you to make a photo fit and then ask you to go and pick the person in the lineup who looks most like the photo
fit.
He could pick out that bloke without looking at the photo. I mean, he still has the memory of the bloke's face in his head. So the photo fit is entirely separate to that.
Well, he's literally seen one of those men before, and the other four he has not. And also, I was describing how this guy has a unique face. What a great sight block. They've actually found three other men who have equally bizarrely unique faces and features who look nothing like the stranger.
No. It reminded me, it's like, you ever read the Bash Street Kids in the Beano, Mark? It's like, each one of them is so massively different to the other one in appearance. It's exactly like that. It's like a Bash Street Kids lineup of, like, the first one has absolutely enormous ears. And then there's like a lanky one who's got a really small top of his head. It's great. They must have really trawled Cambridge there to try and find the five weirdest looking men they could to all line up in one place.
Yeah.
That's the sort of, that's how the segment goes. So do you want to know a little bit more about photo fits, Mark?
Go on. Yes, I do. I'd love to know.
Well, first of all, just to say, the computer-aided design center is still there, but it is now a giant multinational IT firm called Aviva. So it's another one of those things where the British government funded something. It did really well, so they sold it off, and now it's much more successful.
Of course it did.
Yeah. And we don't get any of the money for it.
And none of that money comes back.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So the over...
That's all right. We have too much money at the moment, Russ.
So the overarching term for this in the trade is called a facial composite. And originally, the very, very roots of it, they go back to a French police official called Alphonse Bertillon at the end of the 19th century. And he's the man who invented the mugshot, because he, at the time in Paris, when police arrested somebody or convicted somebody or whatever, they would just note down their name and their address. They would not write down a description of them or anything like that. He realized that that's a really bad way of keeping track of criminals, because they could lie about their name and their address. So he realized that photography, the nascent industry of photography, would really help him in this way. So he invented the mugshot, and then he realized that if you chopped up the mugshots, you could keep a sort of like a very sort of primitive database of features, which could then be used to help identify people. But he didn't at the time think about asking witnesses to use it or anything like that. It was just a way of keeping track of what criminals looked like. And then fingerprints came along, and once they got fingerprints, they kind of stopped using it, because obviously fingerprints are much more reliable than photographs, because people can change their hairline, Mark. So then, skip forward about 50 years or so, there was a fella in America, in Los Angeles, who's a detective at the Los Angeles Identification Bureau. And he, in 1959, launched the Identikit. And what he'd done is he got 50,000 mugshots and chopped them all up, and then worked out that different people tend to have similar features. So what he did is he reduced the features down to 500 basic types that can be put together. But rather than using photographs, in order to make it more sort of blend together better, that it was done using drawings. So they were acetates with drawn representations of human faces on them. And this was first used in 1959 to catch an armed robber in LA successfully. And then the first use spot in the UK by Scotland Yard was in 1961. There was a man called Edwin Bush murdered somebody in Soho. And I've put, I don't know if you saw it.
Oh, is that what that is? I did, yeah.
At the bottom of the document.
Yeah.
So on the left there, that is the first ever identikit photo of a murderer in Britain. And on the right is the man that it turned out to be.
It's very good.
It is surprising. It's surprisingly good, isn't it?
Yeah.
Especially that hair. That hair is absolutely bob on. Yeah. And those sticky out ears.
Impressive.
Yeah.
Yeah. And even like the kind of the tight lips.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Very good.
So, and also, the identikit kits were sold by Smith & Wesson, weirdly, of the gun fame. But then, so separately to this, there was a photo-based system being worked on by a man called Jacques Penry, well, a man who called himself Jacques Penry. His real name was Bill Ryan. I don't know why he changed his name to Jacques Penry. But he had published a book in 1939 called How to Read Character from a Face, right? And it turns out the man is an absolute crank and lunatic, okay? I mean, probably some sort of Nazi. I don't really know. You know, he's one of these people that genuinely believe that you could tell people's personality and criminality from how they looked.
What
does it say? I've got a quote from him here. Yeah, so the blurb on his book claimed that you could determine a personality instantly from appearance. Philosophers, for example, would show a marked development of the lower cheek muscles, while idiots and simpletons would have a receding forehead. He proposed to cleanse society of criminals, mental deficits, neurasthenics, and vocational misfits. Obviously, I was quite interested in this man now, and I managed to find a piece of Pathé footage from 1939 of him. But don't worry, this doesn't involve criminals or anything. This involves his way of determining the difference between different girls.
It is my business to detect and analyze facial characteristics. Every year I make my observations on approximately 20,000 people, and the majority of these are boys and girls. I would like you to observe for yourselves the vast difference between two young girls of opposite type. I shall illustrate these on the board. The first one has a forehead something like this. The nose and the forehead have a slope and an outward curve, something on that order, number one. Number two has a much higher vertical forehead with an inward curved nose, large, full lips, and the eyes also are rounded, whereas these are narrow. Number one is aggressive, determined, practical, and much of the motor type. Number two is more feminine, softer, idealistic, sympathetic, and not as practical as the first. There are a wider variety of types, but time will only allow us to deal with these two. Now, here are the two young ladies in question. Ruth is number one and Joan number two. Suppose that you were in the presence of somebody you disliked and they said something disagreeable about you in the presence of others. What would you do?
I'd be furious. When I'm annoyed, I always forget that other people are near me. I think the sparks would fly.
And how would you behave in similar circumstances, Joan?
I think I should blush. I should feel terribly hurt and embarrassed, but I should ignore the person.
Now, another instance. If you went shopping and upon returning you found that the grocer had given you a bad egg, how would you react?
Oh, I'd go back immediately and ask for two. One to replace the bad one and an extra one for the trouble of coming back. That's odd. I'd probably throw it away and think no more about it.
Now, the final question. If you went shopping for a dress, what would be your first consideration?
I'd think first about the durability and quality of the material. And I'd think especially about the price.
And you?
Well, I'd consider the colour first, and the fit and cut second.
The price would probably shock me. But I think if I liked the frock, I'd buy it anyhow.
There, you see, the girls show at every turn the opposite sides of their nature. And I would like you to remember this, that these two distinct profiles represent opposite natures. And in closing, one request, that not to turn and look at your neighbor sitting next to you. Because if your neighbor has a profile like this, she may be staring back at you. If like this, she may blush.
That is all the circumstantial evidence I need to be convinced, Russ. That is incredible.
That's a rigorous science there, isn't it?
Unbelievable. That is astonishing. Imagine wasting your entire professional life on utter bunk. I'm assuming all he ever did was like look for the matching physical attributes and never really give any consideration as to why he thought that might be the case. Am I wrong?
It's so funny because I remember growing up watching Harry Enfield and I had an awareness of what they were taking the mickey out of.
But you got the general.
I'd never actually seen stuff. But
something as egregious as that.
That's that's just as egregious as women know your limits or any of the
labor equals life.
yeah, it's absolute lunacy. I loved it. Yeah, it's good stuff.
yeah, it was. God, I wonder how old those girls were. Women, those women. No, actually, the weird thing is like they looked and they sounded like girls. I don't know. It's weird, isn't it? He was so pleased with himself.
Was he American? I couldn't really say. He had like a really non-specific accent.
I thought he was. I think he was trying to hide an accent. That was my feeling. Jacques Penry, I don't know. I thought he might have been like somewhere from like the Southwest or something like that. I got the distinct sense of somebody who was trying to polish off some regional accent that they were ashamed of.
But despite his complete lunacy regarding this, something good out of this did come. Why did I just say that like that? Something good did come out of this.
I don't know. Turn sideways and let me see if I can draw some kind of judgment as to your idiocy.
Because he spent all this time looking at faces and individual features and things like this. He did come up with separate to the identikit, he came up with the idea of the photo fits. So he went to the Home Office in 1968 and he'd done a very similar thing, but he'd worked out that each facial characteristic, he had 40 different representations of each one. And it was a similar sort of thing where you put them all together. And try and make a you know, a photo fit of the criminal. And this was first used October 1970. A man called John Ernest Bennett murdered a man called James Cameron in Islington. Mm. So they got somebody to put together a photo fit, and it was broadcast on Police 5. I didn't realise Police 5 went all the way back to 1970. I don't know whether it was presented by Shaw Taylor all the way back then. But But this jogged the memory of a shop assistant in Victoria who recognised the photo fit of a man who'd come in to try and buy and bought an umbrella from him. But the cheque had bounced. And in order to verify his identity, the man produced a firearm certificate. that would ring a bell, wouldn't it? You know, if somebody produced a firearm certificate I am who I say I am. Look, here's my gun license. So the police arrested him, and it was a success. But over the years, they kind of realised that this photo fit thing wasn't really what it's all cracked up to be when they found that a lot of the people they eventually arrested didn't really look anything like the photo fit that was produced. And then somebody came up with the e-fit, which was introduced in October 1988. So this, I think, the thing that Rod here has is a nascent version of the e-fit. I couldn't find any connection between Cambridge and the creation of the e-fit, but they must be connected in some way. What I did find was that there's a man called John Platton who claims responsibility mostly for programming the e-fit software, and he's quite protective of the Wikipedia article about e-fits. And there's quite a lot of there's quite a lot of argument going on. So you know, the Wikipedia has a talk page. So he's on there saying, well, I'm the man who invented the e-fit, ask me any questions or whatever, or clarifications. And then some bloke comes swinging in there going, you didn't invent the e-fit, Tony Kitson invented the e-fit, and I handed you the programming language. and then there's all this big back and forth between the two of them. So I think I tried to work out between the arguments what happened, and I think what happened is Tony Kitson is the man who actually invented it, so maybe he worked at this Cambridge lab, I'm not sure. And then it got passed to John Platton, and John Platton was the person who worked on it and developed it mostly. So he's the one that's taking most of the credit. But John Platton is now an enterprise data architect at Costa Coffee, so he doesn't work on it anymore. But he actually whinges on the talk page about Kitson selling the code to somebody else behind his back, stabbing him in the back. So there's a lot of bad blood in the e-fit programming community.
That's brilliant, isn't it? Yeah. You must have been absolutely delighted when you came across that. But I know I would.
Obviously e-fits are used in 30 countries all around the world, and as I said earlier, it's obviously an ever-present feature on Crime Watch. When was the last time you saw an episode of Crime Watch? I haven't seen that for about 30 years, I don't think.
I don't know. I have no idea. The 90s? I don't know. Yeah. I suppose that is about 30 years ago, isn't it?
Yeah. But they've done tests on how effective an e-fit is, and they reckon that if you did a rod type situation here, where you saw somebody, and then the same day you made the e-fit, then the composite would be about 20% effective. But then if the witnesses were required to wait 2 days before creating it, which is actually what tends to happen in real life, the success rate falls to between 3 and 8%. So, you know, it's not brilliant, really, is it?
No. I mean, 20% isn't bad. I can imagine why the police would be like, quick, get them to, or her, there are girls out there too, get them to describe it. Because, like, you know, 1 in 5 chance, like, why wouldn't you? But 3 to 8. Yeah,
but now, after John Platton, he handed the keys to the E-Fit empire over to somebody else, a younger fella.
That's a young man's game. It's a young man's game.
Who'd been working on new software at the University of Kent. And they've now got a thing called the EvoFit. And this is quite interesting. So what this does is, rather than selecting the individual aspects of somebody's face, what they do is they just show loads and loads of full photographs. And they go, did it look like a bit like that person? They go, oh, a little bit. And then it basically, the more they see, and the more it sort of evolves into a face.
I get that. A bit like being at the optician where they go like 1 or 2 and then they, you know, depending on your answer, then it's a flow chart, isn't it? So you kind of, they're taking you down the path that gets closest to your prescription or your description.
Yeah, exactly. And it sort of evolves into a face that looks most like the person.
Yeah, very good.
And they did a field trial of that in 2012. And it indicated that it directly led to the arrest of a suspect and then a conviction in 29% of cases. So that's pretty good. Vast improvement, isn't it?
Yeah, that's very impressive.
Yeah, yeah. So that is identikits and criminals. Anything else, Mark?
I think that basically covered everything, didn't it? Yeah, which is good because there's barely anything to talk about in some of these segments.
A helicopter, although very manoeuvrable, is inherently unstable. If any part of the control system fails, you'll definitely crash. But there are failures that needn't be fatal.
We're going to do something that sounds absolutely crazy to me. We're going to deliberately have engine failure. So when you're ready, Alan. Oh, dear. My stomach.
We're dropping so fast, the upward airflow is speeding up the rotor blades. To our pilot's skill, this is one simulated engine failure we can walk away from. Having demonstrated a safety aspect of this helicopter, its ability to auto-rotate. That means that when the engine was switched off, the blade was feathered so that it moved round like a windmill, going faster and faster and storing up energy like a flywheel. Then at about 40 feet, the pilot changed the angle of the blade to that position. So the air is thrust downwards, using the energy stored in the flywheel effect to cushion the helicopter's landing. You can see how complex the control movements of a helicopter have to be. Its complexity is the price it pays for being so manoeuvrable. And one of the parts that could, if it failed, cause the sort of incident you've just seen is the clutch, that vital link between the engine and the rotor blades. But I was reassured on my first flight because this piece of equipment was on board, a new way of monitoring the health of helicopters, therefore increasing their safety. And it does it by measuring the vibration of all the main parts. Each component vibrates at a particular frequency. This is the vibration signature of the airframe. This, the clutch, and the engine. This is the printout of our helicopter's vibration signatures. And when I compare it with the printout of a brand new helicopter, you can see that they're very similar. So our machine is obviously in good health.
I was saying in the intro about this being the golden age of strike action. I would say it's also probably the golden age of helicopters, isn't it? Sort of the 70s and early 80s, you probably couldn't move for helicopters doing stuff on TV, could you? You know, everyone had a helicopter.
They were incredibly exciting, aren't they?
And there's something about this sort of slightly grainy 70s
I was going to say, they just look better on 70s, yeah, in 70s film photos,
really,
don't they?
Do.
They just fit better. Yeah.
It strongly reminds, yeah, me of the both the opening titles to MASH and the A-Team, where Hannibal, yeah, jumps out of a helicopter. It just looks good. I guess it's maybe a Vietnam thing. Are we slightly mentally associating it with Vietnam? I don't know.
I think it is a more an American thing, because I was thinking about it. It's like, I mean, I'm assuming that's a British helicopter, but it looks very much like an American one. But like, whereas like in the 60s and 70s, if you ever see a British helicopter, they're these weird kind of gigantic double-decker blobs, you know, like melted candle. I don't know. It's like, there's nothing glamorous about them at all. Yeah, I suppose like the Huey kind of in slow motion kind of landing in a clearance to kind of pick up some injured. Yeah, maybe it is. I don't know what it is, but I did not disagree with you. I think even this helicopter here, it just looks glamorous.
Yeah, yeah.
Even though it's flying on a really dull British summer's day, it still looks glamorous.
Certainly, yeah, yeah, yeah. And then obviously that glamour destroyed by Noel Edmonds.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, I know Americans talk about how kind of, you know, Vietnam and Watergate really pricked the innocence of them as a kind of a growing nation. And for us, it really was what Noel Edmonds' helicopter crash, wasn't it?
Absolutely. Yeah.
We just couldn't look at light entertainment ever again the same way.
No, I mean, this is one of the, basically this entire midsection of the program is just full of rubbish. Ugh. This is I'm sure they've only included this because it's the helicopters are, as we said, quite exciting. The invention itself is...
Oh, so dull.
Is fairly dull. And also, it's kind of weird because she's... It looks like she's about to explain one invention and then she moves to another one because the helicopter engine failure bit she does, which I'm still dubious about because I can still hear the engine running. When I just think she's just landed the helicopter. Her pilot has landed the helicopter a bit fast.
It's a slight heavy landing. She also has a really interesting line where she says something along the lines of, that's at least one simulated engine problem you can walk away from. And I did remember thinking, like, surely you should be able to walk away from every simulated engine failure, I think she says. It's like, the whole point of simulating is that you can walk away. So is there a secret story she's trying to scream at us through our TV screens that we're just too subtle to pick up? How many mysterious... Anyway, it doesn't matter. But yeah, it's just a heavy landing. Yeah.
But then she starts talking about how the rotor blades auto-rotate. And I thought, oh, so you think that's going to be the invention, some sort of new type of rotor blade or something like that.
The safety blade or something like that.
But it's not at all. That's just by the by. Actually, the thing is this box of tricks they've got that detects vibration and shows you a graph and tells you whether your helicopter's about to come apart at the seams. And that's it, really. I mean...
I mean, that is it. Yeah, I was interested about the fact that, you know, helicopters have a half life and you couldn't use them after their half life. But other than that, you know, I mean, like, it doesn't really go anywhere. She doesn't really explain. Well, now that we know that the clutch is vibrating at the wrong frequency, what do we scrap the helicopter? Do we replace it? Can it be repaired? There's nothing. It's just.
I mean, it's not...
Hey, at least we saw her in a helicopter. That's fun.
It's nice that... and it's nice that Judith, once again, is dressing the part there in a full helicopter pilot's outfit that she's wearing there.
A full flight suit.
But I thought, well, what can I do? I could tell you some random facts about helicopters, Mark.
Oh, please do.
First of all, everybody thinks that helicopter is helicopter, which is why we have helipads. And there's other things called things like gyrocopters or quadcopters. This is wrong, Mark. The word is actually helico, is from the Greek. Helico, which means spiral or, you know, helix. And pter, as in the beginning of, you know, like pterodactyl or pteranodon, which means wings. So that's how the word should be
spiral
should,
wings.
How the word should be split. But obviously no, you know, English speaking person would think that there's a word pter. So that's why we changed it to heli and copter. But they reckon the use of helicopters over the years has saved more than 3 million lives in war and peace from you know, rescuing people from the sea or from, you know, battle zones or whatever, or mountainsides and all that sort of thing. There's estimated to be 45,000 helicopters in total worldwide, which isn't that many, is it, really?
That doesn't seem that many, no.
I imagine Edmund's got about three.
he had.
And we're talking about sort of auto-rotation here that Judy's talking about, where the blades, even if the engine fails, the blades will still keep spinning due to aerodynamics. The longest one of those in history was a man called Jean Bollet in 1972, when he flew a helicopter to a record height of nearly 41,000 feet. And he got all the way up there, but because it's minus 63 degrees up there, the the engine went out. So
he then fell from the highest height.
Yeah, but because the blades were auto rotating as he was falling, he was able to land safely. So that's a stroke of luck, isn't it?
Lucky blighter.
And equally, in the United States Army, there's an award for successfully doing an auto-rotation under emergency conditions. And it's called the Broken Wing Award, which, you know, big one of the Mr. fans out there.
I don't know about you. It was immediately in my head. I've almost forgotten about Welcome Home to ITV, thanks to Mr. Yeah. Almost.
And one last thing, the big nut that holds the rotor blades on a helicopter. It's basically just one giant nut. It's called the Jesus nut. because if that goes, you just pray to Jesus. Yeah. That's it. Oh, you're done.
Isn't that fun? I've only been in a helicopter once, and now I know why. There aren't many of them.
No, one more time to me. I don't think I have. I've never been in a helicopter.
Yeah, a few years ago in New Zealand, it was a lot of fun. Yeah, it was scary because it just feels unnatural, but yeah.
But yeah, anyway, regarding this invention, I looked up on the invention, it had the name of the company. It was called Data Acquisition Limited. They filed their final accounts in 1996. They went out of business, but they've been running since 1964. So, you know, maybe the boss retired or something. Maybe. But the actual technology itself is widely used these days. It's called Health and Usage Monitoring Systems, or HUMS for short. And this particular part of it is called vibration health monitoring. And you know what industry that it was majorly introduced to in 1990, Mark?
Maybe oil
rigs? Yes, the North Sea industry adopted it in the 1990s, and it massively decreased the accident rate immediately.
Oh, good.
So it was it's capable of detecting 70% of all failures that would have happened otherwise. So that's a lot of lives saved there. Mm-hmm. And this immediately led the Civil Aviation Authority to say, right, you have to put this in all aircraft, not just the oil rig ones. So any aircraft carrying 9 or more passengers has to have one of these systems in it. So it's, and there's, you know, you can go online, order one if you want. I couldn't find any prices. I imagine it's probably quite expensive because, you know, helicopter shit in it. So, it's, you know,
yeah,
we'll put a markup on that.
They see any helicopter pilot coming, don't they, from a mile away?
But yeah, so, I mean, the invention, you know, is a success and is useful. Just doesn't make great TV, that's all.
No, it's very boring. Yeah. Next.
Meanwhile, on the ground, engineers have for years been demonstrating some novel ideas for improving transport down here. This screw-driven perpetual people mover graced the Wembley World Exhibition of 1924. By 1967 and Montreal's Expo, it was a monorail doing much the same thing. Looking for the ultimate solution, a Japanese research team have tried a tracked rocket. Unreliable. Their opposite numbers in Massachusetts developed a superconducting electric passenger capsule. Unstable. And the French have tried an aero engine on board a hovering monorail. Uncomfortable. We've seen taxis on monorails which can pass one another. Electrically powered monorails which can go faster than trains. And the ill-fated British tracked hovercraft, killed off when the money from Westminster ran out. Then there was the rubber-tired vehicle, which hoped to bring the benefits of road travel to the railway. We've had a hanging monorail, too complicated, an American system which took too long to make work, and a Victorian overhead railway still going strong. Some have tried magnetic levitation, others light rubber tires on concrete. But for one reason or another, the conventional railway has proved a tough nut to crack.
Choo-choo!
Ay, ay, ay. What is this, Ross?
What was that?
What was that? I think when I was seeing the notes, I think I called it a list of failed replacements for rail travel. Because that's what it is. He literally, all he does is list different types of rail transport, most of which are actually the same as other examples he has tried to give different names to. Some of which are good examples of things he says don't work.
Also, a lot of them aren't replacements for trains. A lot of them are types of mass transit, like more sort of small-scaled mass transit that would never... Well,
people movers are used in specific areas, not to replace rail, but to probably replace buses or walking or driving, you know, in like theme parks or airports, you know, completely. You don't want it. First time I watched this, this is one of the examples of the first time I watched this, I laughed when I realized it went absolutely nowhere. Because I was thinking, like, God, this is a long list. I cannot wait to see what example of new approach they have that was going to, you know, take all these things he's putting in the bin and then reveal to us the bright new future. God, be really interesting. Because he's basically written off absolutely everything else. And then, of course, it just stops.
Just ends with a strange sort of clown car thing just bursting on a railway track.
That Kelsey Priest, he's driving.
That was a strange thing, because obviously I assume that most of this is cobbled together from footage from previous episodes.
Yes.
But the only presenter you see in any of the trains is him.
Yes, correct.
He's seen three or four of them.
Yeah, definitely.
So is he the only person that's ever done train segments on tour as well? I don't know. Or have they done so many that they're able to just only pick ones with him in it? I don't know.
As you rightly point out, it's hardly surprising if they're the ones, if he's the one they send off to do the trains, is it? I mean, who would you send? You're gonna send Raymond off? No, you balls.
No.
He's too busy. You know, he's too busy flying to his boat.
Yeah.
The thing that really got me about this, especially in the second and third viewing, was Rod. So you point out that in the voiceover, he says, "You wrote it down here." Meanwhile, on the ground, so obviously we cut from a helicopter in full flight, and meanwhile on the ground, which implies that actually they did cobble this together. This is filler, and they brought Rod in to do a voiceover. It seems unlikely that it segued in from a similar air segment, and it's like it's cobbled together.
It's just occurred to me. Does that make Rod a scab?
I was wondering the same, but I wasn't going to question that, because it might be that, as you said, the strike ended the 24th of October. They knew they were, I don't know, possibly. But again, does that surprise you? I don't know. No. There's nothing terribly unsurprising about Rod's involvement in any of this. The thing that got me, though, was he was editorializing, which I found quite surprising. So I actually wrote the full list out because it amused me to do so. And as much because when you watch it go by quite quickly, it's actually difficult to track how many examples they use. And in the end, like, there's plenty, there's loads. But like he talks about, like, in Japan, they tried a track rocket. And then you see amusing footage of a Japanese man having to shove this rocket by hand through some kind of grid. And then Rod goes, unreliable. And then it goes to, you know, meanwhile, their counterparts in Massachusetts tried a superconducting electric passenger capsule. Unstable. The French tried an aero engine and board a hovering monorail. Uncomfortable. It's like, who gives you the right to make these judgments? Especially the uncomfortable thing. It's like, because that one actually is a proper thing that's in use. It kind of reminded me of the monorail in Fahrenheit 451. The film, where they have a monorail that seems to be kind of jet-powered, and it looked like the same thing. I assume it was, because I think that was filmed in the Low Countries or France or somewhere like that. What makes it uncomfortable? That really annoyed me. It's like, what makes you the expert on comfort, Michael? Well,
this is the thing, Mark. You'll notice that I wrote in the notes, there's no way I'm individually researching all of the trains in this. It would take forever.
It would take forever. Yeah.
But then I got so annoyed by Rod's editorialising. I was desperate to prove him wrong. So I have researched all of the trains in this, and he's ready. And he's wrong multiple times.
Of course he bloody is. Or the hanging monorail, too complicated, he says. But even that little bit, like, without you telling me what happens, I remember thinking, okay, it was too complicated the first time you tried, but now that you've done it, you'd be able to do it much quicker when you roll it out. But then the other thing was, like, he slags off hanging monorails, but about the only one he thinks that is any good is a Victorian overhead railway that's still going strong.
It's a hanging monorail.
It's a hanging monorail, and because it's in Wuppertal in Germany, which I've always wanted to go to, because they have this amazing monorail that goes through the middle of the city, and it is Victorian era. Though that did beg the question. I was thinking about this. I almost wrote down the notes. It's like, we call it the Victorian era because obviously it's the era where Victoria reigned. It's like, is it agreed? Yeah. Everyone else calls it the Victorian. Do the Germans call it the Victorian era? I don't think But yeah, because he kind of implies it's in Britain. It's like, no, it isn't.
No. I looked up Wuppertal where it was, and it's less than three hour train journey from my house, Mark. So
you gotta go. We gotta go. Next time I'm over, we're going to Wuppertal. Oh, 3 hours. That's much closer than I thought. Oh, that's exciting. I've always wanted to go. It looks
amazing.
Basically
a direct train. So yeah, we will do that.
Oh, fabulous.
Obviously, I won't go into too much detail, but I will quickly whiz through these trains. Just
be quick enough to prove them wrong and then
exactly,
we can move on with
So the first one, screw-driven perpetual people mover. That was at the Wembley World Exhibition in 1924. That was invented by William Urath Lewis and Benjamin Radcliffe Atkins. It's patented as the Atkins-Lewis system of continuous transport. They demonstrated it first in Aldwych in London. And this is quite clever. What it was is the carriages, there was a giant screw and the carriages went along the screw. But the coil of the screw changed in length and slackness depending on where they were. So if it was near a station, it was really tightly coiled. So that meant that the carriage went slower because it was going along coils, it was going short distance.
That's very clever.
And then between stations, the screw would stretch out and it would move quicker along the line.
Faster, yeah.
That clever. Oh, that's a really clever idea.
That is very smart.
But yeah, so they had it at the exhibition, and then after the exhibition finished, they took it down in 1925, and they tried to revive it in 1959, but no one was interested, so never saw it ever again. I think that's due a resurgence, because I think it's such a clever idea. Anyway, number two, the monorail at the 1967 Montreal Expo. It's actually called the Mini Rail. I found out all about this on www.monorail.org. Turns out that there's a website entirely dedicated to monorails. I don't know about you, but whenever I hear monorail, all I think of is The Simpsons.
Yeah, I know, absolutely.
Monorail. But yes, so this one, it ran all around the expo, and it ran over a big body of water, and then went through a geodesic dome,
which we see in the video.
Another callback. There's a lot of callbacks to previous episodes in this episode. And it went, according to monorail.org, it went at a blistering 7.5 miles an hour.
Monorail.org
carried 7 million passengers in the first 3 months of operation, and there's part of it today is still running.
Cool. In Montreal.
Yeah, in Montreal. So it's still running. So Rod, I don't know whether Rod said anything about it, but it's not a failure. It's still running. So then number three, the Japanese tracked rocket. Professor Hisanojo Ozawa, 1967. He wanted to make a train travel at supersonic speeds. So he was doing tests with models, and he managed to get a model. It's like, I think it's like a tenth of the size of what a proper train would be. He managed to get it to go 571 miles per hour by strapping rockets to it. It was deemed too dangerous after, a lot of them crashed and exploded, unsurprisingly. Number four, the Magnaplane, 1973. That was the one in Massachusetts, done by MIT and some engineers from other companies. These were cylindrical vehicles in an aluminium trough. But they had superconducting magnets on the underside, which meant that they didn't actually touch the trough. They're essentially hovering, probably maybe a forerunner to maglev. Number five, aerotrain. That was the one that he said was uncomfortable.
Uncomfortable, yeah.
This one very nearly came to fruition. This was developed in France between 1965 and 1977. It used aerodynamics. So it looked kind of like it was maglev, but it had no magnets involved. It used aerodynamics to float on a cushion of air over the rail. And so it's kind of more like an aerospace project than a train. But it could reach speeds of 267 miles per hour floating on this air cushion. Mm. The French government said, oh, this is pretty decent. Well, they signed a contract to build the first line on the outskirts of Paris. And then in 1974, a new French president came in called Valéry Giscard d'Estaing. D'Estaing?
D'Estaing.
His wife was the granddaughter of an industrialist called Eugene Schneider. And Eugene Schneider ran Schneider Group, which was a major French railway and steel building company. And suddenly, that project got kiboshed instantly. And then the poor old engineer behind the whole project died a year later with a broken heart.
Oh, God.
Number six, taxis that could pass each other. No idea what that is. I mean, there's no...
It's nonsense, isn't it?
Number seven, fast electric ones. Couldn't really see what that was. Just looked like a plane monorail. Number eight, the tracked hovercraft. This is developed in the UK throughout the 1960s, initially by Sir Christopher Cockerell's laboratory, who obviously invented the hovercraft itself. So it had some advantages. The lack of friction meant that it, over 140 miles an hour, it was more energy efficient than an actual train. It had obviously a really, really smooth ride. And because it was hovering, the tracks had no wear and tear. So you could have much lighter, you know, less robust tracks. So it was much easier to lay tracks for it. And the first test vehicle was called the RTV-31, which we saw in this footage here. It could reach 104 miles per hour in 1973. So, but then a week after it did its first test, old Tarzan himself, Michael Heseltine, comes in, and he was the aerospace minister at the time. He said, this is costing far too much money. It's already cost $5 million in funding, and we're not going to see hovercraft trains until the end of the century. This is absolute way. And British Rail were already working on a new high-speed train, which was far much more, you know, sensible. So they just put all their money in that instead. So that got binned off as well. You can still see the hover train. I think it's outside Peterborough somewhere. You can go and look at it if you want. Number 9, hanging monorail. Rod calls this too complicated. This is absolutely nonsense. There's several of them around the world, mainly in Japan and Germany. Number 10, American system that took too long to work. Absolute garbage, Rod. This is the WVU-PRT, which connects the 3 Morgantown campuses of West Virginia University to the city's downtown area. It is still in existence and has been there since 1975. Actually, you'll like this, Mark. It was announced in President Nixon's budget speech to Congress in January 1972. And he said, if we can send 3 men to the moon 200,000 miles away, we should be able to move 200,000 people to work 3 miles away. So, yeah.
Can I give it that?
Your mate Nixon was a big fan of this. So it opened in 1975, cost $130 million, and it was 98% reliable for most of its life. And then it started to drop in reliability, but they've completely refurbished it, and it reopened in 2021, and it's back up to full power again. So
I have to say, I thought I recognized it because I feel like I've heard about it in the last couple of years, and now I know why.
So,
because it is, because I knew, I looked at it, I thought, that looks like that one I've heard about that's at that university in America somewhere.
So Rod is talking absolutely out of his arse there.
Absolute balderdash.
Number 11, we've got the Wuppertaler Srebivan, as we've just been talking about. Designed by Eugen Langen, who also patented the sugar cube and sold that to Sir Henry Tate of Tate and Lyle fame. Originally, he offered it to Berlin, Munich and Breslau, and they all turned it down. Opened in 1901. Still going strong, transports 25 million passengers annually. And there's a special fancy one called the Kaiser. Kaiserwagen.
The Kaiserwagen, so, yeah.
Maybe rather than Victorian era, they call it
the
Wilhelmian era.
The Wilhelmian.
Era. Number 12 is some non-specific maglev thing. And number 13 is the rubber-tired metro, which, I don't know, does he poo-poo that? No, he just mentions it.
He just says, others rubber tires on concrete.
Wikipedia lists 48 of those around the world, with 3 more under construction. And that includes Gatwick, Heathrow and Stansted. All of their mass transit are rubber-tired.
Oh, of course.
Ones. Yeah, so all in all, a lot of successes in there. Rod's full of nonsense.
Kale surprise, Russ. It seems to be the catchphrase today. Kale surprise.
Anything else about that?
Hey, he finishes on the line at the end, but for one reason or another, the conventional railway has proven to be a tough nut to crack. What does he mean it's a tough nut to crack? It's like,
it's not that
we cracked it.
There's a problem.
It's called a railway.
Yeah, it's not a problem.
It's like it's perfectly
reasonable. It's not like it's presenting
reasonable.
Any problems to us, is it?
No, it's, you know, it's what's wrong with it? I don't understand. It's like, and all these things that you've listed, not least of which the fact that you've pointed out that a lot of them are successes, they're all serving completely different purposes.
Yeah.
They aren't designed to replace the rail. It's not like everyone's sitting there thinking like, oh, we've had the railways for quite a long time. Really, it looks a bit uncool. You know, we've got to replace it lest, you know, better, bigger countries think we're, you know, really old. I don't understand. I just thought that was a weird way to end it. And he seems perfectly happy to end it there. So I don't know, maybe we should too.
Oh, well, speaking of cool looking railways, the music, Coronation Scots by Vivian Ellis.
Yes.
It's named after a train unveiled in 1937 for somebody's coronation. Which one's coronation would that be? Edward, maybe?
It was George and Elizabeth.
Yeah. It's a beautiful looking train, the Coronation Scot. But this piece of music, it's an incredibly famous piece of music. But it's another one, like one of those ones where you can't quite put your finger on where you know it from. It's just used all the time. Interestingly, this recording of it is done by Sidney Torch and his orchestra. Do you remember who Sidney Torch and his orchestra are, Mark?
I don't. No, it doesn't.
You've got
a
mention in episode 3 of our podcast.
Really? Yes. Okay.
He's the
like I listen to this podcast.
He's the person that did the music to the fictional BBC news program in 2001: Space Odyssey.
Oh wow! Okay, all right. I'm back in there. You got me. You pulled me back in.
Yeah. So that's another callback there. But it was mainly used as a theme tune to a BBC radio serial called Paul Temp, which ran between 1938 and 1968. And it was about a crime fiction author who was also an amateur private detective. That's basically Murder, She Wrote, isn't it?
Yes, it is, yeah.
Yeah. Rest in peace, Angela Lansbury.
You can go to Angela if you want.
Angela Lansbury. Right, well, speaking of angles.
Yeah, go on and finish that one. Brilliant.
This ungainly chair, it's called a bosun's chair, is a traditional way of getting up and down masts, but it's a bit clumsy, even when the boat is moored safely at anchor. But more importantly, it needs a couple of strong pairs of arms to winch me up and down. Of course, if you're not a sailor, like me, you may well be wondering why anyone should want to go up a 30-foot mast. Well, a halyard could come loose, for instance, or maybe you want to fix your navigation lights. The new prevention of collisions regulations brought into force last year made life much more difficult for all sailing vessels, especially small craft like this one. More and more of them are using this. It's a tricoloured navigational light, and it replaces the three lights that this boat used to have. It goes right at the top of the mast up there. The problem with it is that it's only got one bulb, and if it goes, you're not only up the creek, you're up the mast as well. And that means there's nothing for it but the bosun's chair. Or does it? Well, Neil Bird has come up with the answer, and he's invented the bosun's ladder. Neil's prototype was simple and clever. These ropes have to be knotted in such a way as to form triangular steps, one that falls that side and the other that falls that side, alternately right and left. At least that's the way they should hang, and they will when they're on the mast. Now, this thimble here is the top of the rope ladder, and what you do is you attach it to the halyard like that. I'll just pull the halyard up a bit, and there's the first rung. Here's a slide which you just slip into the standard mast track like so. The problem here is, to show you how the ladder works, I've got to climb up it.
Now, Mark, I think it's time to add something to our audit. And I'm proposing it's simply the word boats, ? We see a boat every episode now, don't we? Do we not see a boat every episode? It feels like we do.
It certainly feels like it, doesn't it?
Yeah. I had no idea that boats were so impregnated in British society through the 70s and 80s that they were featured on Tomorrow's World every episode.
And it's not like shipping. It really is boats, yeah. Isn't it? It's like it's little yachts. It's no, you're not wrong. I'm just opening up the master list, Russ. I'm going to add that in there because, you know, I second your suggestion. I think it's probably long overdue, frankly. Yeah. We could have been adding ticks all over the place if we'd done this earlier. It's weird, isn't it? It really is odd.
Yeah. And in this case, they seem to have just wedged in a boat segment regardless of quality.
To my mind, they've wedged in half a boat segment.
Yeah.
Because it just ends with Kieran halfway up a mast, like wheezing and panting as the camera pulls back. And he hasn't done the one thing you would assume he's going to do, which is replace the light bulb.
Yeah.
Instead, he's just kind of left there and we move on with our lives. It's very odd. This is another one of these segments that just sort of ends rather than concludes.
Yeah.
It just stops rather than concludes. I don't.
So essentially he's saying that if you're lucky enough to own a yacht, as you know 90% of the British population are, you are at some point going to have to go up the mast to either fix what halyard, I think he called it. I don't know what that is.
This is halyard, yeah.
Part of the sail or something.
Doesn't matter.
Or new safety regulation requires a light that's got a single bulb that might go to be on top of the mast, and you have to go up there to fix it. And the only way previously to do that is like go on like an old fashioned window cleaners swing thing that hoists you up to the top of the mast. But now someone's come up with an amazing new invention, the rope ladder.
They're rogue letters, I mean, yeah.
How has it taken...
Should we explain that... I want you to picture a ladder, but it's made of rope. I know. So odd, isn't
A,
it?
Why has it taken until the late 70s for somebody to think of this? B, I'm pretty sure I've seen in plenty of pirate films them climbing up the mast on rope ladders. So
yeah,
I don't know what's going on. And also, I mean, I see quite a lot of, boats these days, Mark, where I live. And the vast majority of the ones I see with masts, the mast folds down so it can get under bridges. Is that not the case? Did that not used to be the case? I don't know. All right.
Don't look at me. we're clearly from the generation just after everyone owned boats.
It just seems easier if you wanted to do that, just to lower the mast and then you know.
Well, not even that, but like yeah, you're not wrong. But maybe that's difficult when you're in like a storm or something. You have to replace the light bulb. But it's like, as I said to you, it's like, why didn't they just build masts that have little bits sticking out so that you can like a telegraph pole? Mm. They've had little ladders for ages. All you have to do is you just need something to get up high enough so that you can use the inbuilt. I'm sure that would be much more stable. Because the thing about this rope ladder, it's not even straight down. It's like each of the laddery bits are like
rungs.
The rungs, that's a good word. That, yeah, they're sort of like left and right, so like it's inherently and possibly dangerously unstable.
Yeah, and Kieran does not look like he's enjoying himself, does he?
No,
I don't think he's got a head for heights there. He's certainly no. Who was it? Was it John Noakes climbing Nelson's column?
Yeah, Nelson's column. Yeah. God, that's horrible. Even now, watching that again, especially that bit where he has to kind of climb out at an angle so that basically he's just like hanging on for dear life as he keeps going up so they can go over the lip of... awful.
Yeah.
Dreadful stuff.
Yeah.
He's not having a great time at all. He really is struggling as well right at the end. And I think it's probably partly because he's frightened. And I think that's perfectly legitimate. I'm not going to complain about that as someone who does not have a head for heights.
But yeah, I mean, what can we say about this? Well, I mean, I could tell you, Mark.
Anything? Go on then. The bosun's ladder.
I couldn't find Neil Byrne, the inventor of this particular ladder, unfortunately. However, you'll be shocked, Mark, to discover that rope ladders for going up boat masts are widely available on the internet.
Wow. Yeah. Oh, isn't the internet marvellous?
Yeah.
There's something for everyone, isn't
it? One of the advantages of living in the future, Mark, is that, you know, you can get a rope ladder to your house at any time of day or night. But the one I found that's mostly similar to this is called the Mast Mate, available from mastmate.com. Surprisingly expensive, I'd say, for what it is, because it's basically just a load of nylon webbing stitched together. If you want a 20 to 27 foot mast mate, it's going to cost you $292. If you want a 50 foot mast mate, it's going to cost you $455. It's just some nylon and buckles. I think there's a, you know. But of course, much like helicopter owners, I think boat owners are, you know.
Yeah, they're asking for it.
They really are.
The way they're dressed, they're asking for it. They're just begging to be charged a fortune for a rope ladder.
Why is it that, have we asked this before? Why is it that sailing types wear their jumpers around their shoulders?
I don't know. It's a good question. I don't know. I was sort of trying to think of a comedic reason, and I can't even think of that. except they need to take it off quickly to wave it at someone because their wife in the kitchen has slipped or something like that. The galley, I should say. So sorry, boaters. My language slipped there.
Who do you think we've got more listeners in the North Sea industry or sailing?
Do you think we have more yachters listening, or do you think we have more oilmen?
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, crikey. Yachters. No one who actually works for a living listens to us or has the time to listen to us, I think. No, let's swiftly move on.
Have you ever given a thought to how you lift a heavy sack? Watching carefully, you'll have noticed that the men lifted their bags in the same way, while each of the women did it differently. Men, all men this is, tend to keep their legs straight and stoop like that to lift, while women, although they all bend their knees because of skirts and high heels, they do it with their spines in all sorts of complicated positions. Here at the University of Surrey, they're studying the way women lift and the maximum weight they can safely cope with. All the women volunteers are asked to swallow a pill, like this. It's a radio transmitter which can measure the varying pressures in the abdomen.
And that job is done by a small metal diaphragm at this end. At the other end, a mercury battery. So the pill can transmit for up to 48 hours. The only problem is swallowing it. But once it's down, you're ready to take part in their extremely vigorous experiments. How the angle of my spine changes during different movements is shown at a glance by these spinal markers. And this aerial around my waist picks up pressure changes monitored by the pill, passing them on to recording equipment in the test laboratory. As I bend forward, the pressure on my spine increases. And if I lift something in this position, my abdominal muscles contract and increase the pressure in my stomach. The pill inside my stomach transmits any change of pressure to this oscilloscope. And the higher the peaks, the higher the pressure. And when I increase the weight, that exerts greater stress on my spine and therefore makes the pressure higher. But it's not just the weight that matters. The way that you lift is also vitally important. And lifting with your spine in this curved position is wrong. It's also dangerous if you lift with your spine twisted like that. In fact, the way to lift a load like this one is that way. Research here is still at an early stage, but it's already established that women handle weights in a wide variety of dangerous ways, and not surprisingly, that they can't lift as much as men. Both need to be sorted out at the moment because women are taking far more of the traditionally male jobs. In fact, a recent report for the Equal Opportunities Commission asked for more information to assess whether women really can cope with heavy jobs in industry.
How's your back, Mark? You ever suffer from back problems?
On the odd occasion, yes, I do sometimes, yeah. And mostly to do with my posture, I think. I've also pulled my back muscles a couple of times. Once, actually, the start of the Iraq War. So I managed to watch the first 3 days of that war laid up in bed. So really, I know what they were going through.
Yeah, I mean, this segment raises a lot of questions with me.
Raises a lot of questions, yes.
Because... what is going on at the beginning of it? And the initial part of it, I find baffling. We open, and they appear to be on a golf course. Does it look like a golf course to you?
It looked like the front garden of the Teletubbies house.
they're like a. It's a very well manicured area that they're in.
Yeah, it's
they're
very
in front of a. They're in front of a pond.
We eventually find out it's the University of Sussex or Surrey. No, University of Surrey. So right. It's some kind of green space in a, you know, out of town university. But I was equally confused because it starts off with, was it three men picking up a bag of spuds? Then Judith picking up a bag of spuds. In the background, there's a man just raking nothing. Yeah, and then way up on a flat hill, there's just cars. And it's just so odd. It's a very odd, peculiar sight to behold. Yeah.
And then these people come in and lift, I think, two blokes and two women, I think.
Was it two blokes, two women?
I think so.
I don't remember.
Come in and pick up these randomly placed large sacks of spuds. So it looked like they've probably got some, if they've genuinely full of spuds, they'd have some real heft.
Oh, like 15, 20 Ks or something like that. You know, they're big. They're big bags, like big, you know, huge kind of.
And using the, and specifically, Judith says, did you see the difference or did you notice the difference between the men and the women? And I replayed this multiple times and I could not work out what she was talking like. Everyone just picked up the bag of spuds random. Judith claims that, and she says all men she's not taking the mickey. I think she actually specifically genuinely means this. All men pick up bags of potatoes in an identical fashion. And that women don't. Women all just are just absolute loose cannons in the old spud lifting department, and they could be lifting in any manner of ways. And I just that's not true, is it?
It's certainly not true now. I, It was... I don't know what to say, Russ. Let me put it another way. What evidence do we have that that's not true? Of course it's not true. It's not true. Like, but basically she says, like, women pick things up differently because of skirts and high heels. Means that they're, like, they have to stand in really awkward ways. Like, if they weren't wearing skirts and high heels, she doesn't continue to say they would all pick them up by men. And I think you and I landed on the same thing, which is like, but the men are picking it up wrong.
Yeah.
Like, everyone is picking stuff up wrong.
Because she says that all men arch their backs and keep their legs straight.
They keep their legs straight and they arch their backs.
But anybody who's ever had any health and safety training at work knows that is, you're meant to...
Dangerous.
You're meant to keep your back straight and bend your knees.
Was it like the Australian nurse lift or something like that? It's got like a proper name. It's like, keep your legs bent, back stiff. Use your legs. That's where your leg muscles are, where the real power is, not your lower back.
So immediately, anybody who's had any health and safety training at work, any man who's had that against any man who's not had that would not lift bags of spuds the same. No. So all men don't lift things the same immediately.
No.
It's such a strange thing to assert at the beginning. And
the fact that she says all men.
And then,
she really emphasises that.
And then if this is the case, and it seems like her initial proposition is that all men lift bags of spuds the same, but that's fine. So they're doing these experiments on women in particular because women are having to lift more things and we need to teach them how to lift things properly so they don't do their backs in. But then at the end, she shows you how you should lift things and it's not the way that men lift things. So why is this experiment not been done on all people, not just...
But then she never mentions like, oh, maybe I should tell the men.
Yeah, they're doing it wrong as well.
Nope. Yeah, it's so odd. It's weird. This just, let's be honest, this is a bad segment along with most of the others.
And also, and then I was not expecting the first thing that they do to analyze how people's backs work is to swallow a pill full of mercury-filled batteries. Pill.
And it's not just a pill. I mean, what is it? It's like, because it's huge.
Yeah.
It's so big.
There's no way I'd be able to swallow that. No way. I don't know what it's like. It's like swallowing the middle of a Kinder egg.
It's not quite that big, but it's closer than their pill. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, and I was quite interested. So that's got a pressure sensor in it.
Yes, a diaphragm, she says.
Which, obviously, I understand. I can understand how, I can understand that it would be probably quite good at taking the pressure of your stomach or your intestines, which is where it is. But how is that? I'm not sure how that's related to back muscles or spine or anything else that they're testing. Like, what? Does that affect internal pressure to such a degree when you're bending over that it's measurable? I guess maybe it is. I don't know. But I don't know what they're measuring.
I don't know either. Pressure, she just says. And obviously the more strain she puts on her lifting, because you see her in a kind of a prototype gym where she's kind of, pulling, elastic cords attached to weights.
Almost
and whatever,
like a Rocky, like a up. Rocky montage.
Yeah, it's like a proper Rocky montage, isn't it? Yeah. Yeah, you don't see her like punching any beef. Though amusingly, when she does talk about women having to lift more, it cuts to Judith Hann picking up a tea tray full of weights off a coffee table.
Yeah.
So, that's great, isn't it?
But yeah, she's got all sorts of stuff, and she's got a shirt lifted up, so she's got a midriff exposed and all sorts of stuff strapped to her, and then she's got what looked like drinking straws poked into her spine.
Yeah.
Which presumably they're doing some sort of...
Like she's Hellraiser's Capri Sun or something like that.
Yeah. There was no... I don't know how they're taking measurements with that. There was no indication of... Were they using a camera to film her spine movements? I don't know. That didn't explain that.
Did not explain. No, not one. No, they didn't. They didn't explain any of it. It starts off, it's nonsense. They don't explain what they do. And then it concludes in a really half-hearted way. Next...
Both of Judith's segments give us the old switcheroo, don't they, really? Where they start off looking like they're going to be one thing and then turn into something else.
The old classic bait and switch from Hann, yeah? I was watching the last 10 minutes of The Sting last night, Russ.
Oh, yeah.
I know this game plays.
So the old sleight of hand.
Exactly. Oh, nice one.
Yeah.
There's our episode title.
Obviously, the thing that came out of this that I was most interested in is this swallowable detector pill thing. So I thought I'd look into that to find out what's going on there. Well, first of all, actually, I wondered what happens if you swallow a mercury battery. Turns out that they've been banned in the EU since 1991 and the US since 1996 due to how incredibly toxic they are. But they were used mainly as like watch batteries and hearing aid batteries when they were in use. There's absolutely no benefit can come from swallowing a battery. little kids love swallowing.
Thank you, Russell.
Little kids love swallowing. They do. And apparently,
they look so delicious.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, they could create a hole in the esophagus within 2 hours. They can even burn through the esophagus into the windpipe. Damage the vocal cords. They can even burn through the blood vessels in the chest area, including the aorta. So, I mean, you know, in the United States, an average of 3,000 kids swallow a battery each year. So, yeah. But once they banned the mercury batteries, they started in the medical things, they started using silver oxide batteries. And turns out you could eat a bowl of silver oxide batteries, you'd be fine. They're totally non-toxic. So these days, if a doctor asked you to swallow one, wouldn't worry. But this pill is called, these days they're called digital pills. They originally, when they were invented, called the radio pill. And I was amazed by how early they were invented. They were invented by a man called Vladimir Zvorykin, who was also the man who invented the cathode ray tube that's used in TVs. He invented it in the late 50s, and he was in a hospital in America, and he got one of his fellow doctors to swallow it, and they tied a bit of string around it just in case anything went wrong. But it all worked out okay. And then they started doing experiments with it, and rather than tying a string around it, if it ever went down the wrong hole or whatever, they just get really strong magnets and push it around the inside of the people's bodies. But yeah, so the pill's got like a diaphragm on it, which reacts to fluctuations in the intestines, and then these vibrations are then sent out as a radio signal and you can detect it. So what this pill that Judith's got is like 20 years old as an invention. So I'm surprised it's not been on the show before, to be honest.
Well, I mean, it might have been, but yeah, we haven't seen it yet. Yeah.
But obviously these days, that you know, technology's moved on now. You can now get ones that have got cameras in them, which they use for non-invasive endoscopy. And you can get a pill that's got a camera that can transmit it up to 2.7 megabits per second. It's pretty good, isn't it? It's like a proper sort of inner space type stuff. but then in 2017, the FDA approved the first ever digital medication. So it was looked like a normal packet of pills, or like pot of pills. But one of the pills, the first one you take, has a Bluetooth transmitter in it, and it stays in the stomach and monitors the rest of the medication as you take it over the course. So it connects to your phone, and it just keeps an eye on the medication levels in your stomach and tells you when to take the next one and all of things like that.
Gosh, but how does it stay there? Does it just not digest,
I guess so. I mean, yeah, maybe. I don't know.
Does it like, or a bit like in a space? Is it like
clamps on?
Clamp on, yeah.
But the what I thought was weird was the medication that it's for is schizophrenia, right? And I'm no doctor, Mark, and I'm not an expert, and I don't, you know, protest to be an expert in schizophrenia. But the things I've always heard...
It is important that we restate this every now and then. I know people listening think we are very clever.
The things I've always heard about schizophrenia is that a lot of times there's the idea that people are, you know, they've like paranoid fantasies, don't they? So the idea that the one person that you're giving this medication that is literally inside them, monitoring them and speaking to them
sending
via their
signals,
phones, is people with this sort of condition. I don't know. It just seems like a strange one to go for first. But yeah. So I mean, but there's a bit of pushback because essentially you're inserting spyware into human beings. So I think that's still the only medication that's had this facility so far. But I'm sure it'll probably, you know, happen more in the future. Seems like quite futuristic, doesn't it? But as far as back pain goes, 300,000 people a year get back pain due to manual handling accidents. And 80% of adults suffer a back injury in their lifetime. Luckily, I haven't yet, Mark. That might be more of an indication of...
You're like a... yeah. But that like you're Bruce Willis from Unbreakable, aren't you?
Yeah.
Jammy bastard.
And the statistics said that women and men are affected equally, but I looked at the graph on the Health and Safety Executive's website, and definitely there is a slight slightly more women. Over the age of 45, it's slightly more women that get it than men. So I was wondering whether, you know, the older women did not have benefit from whatever this research is that Judith has done.
Yeah, that's a nice theory. Yeah. I like that. Yeah. Entirely improving. Yeah, the best kind of theory.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
I always think one of the most charming aspects of American society is that everything here is just that little bit bigger than it has to be. And that goes right from the warmth of the welcome through to the size of the gas bill. Certainly, it takes in the number of radio stations. Just listen to this lot.
Pizza pie, Justin. Hey, dude in there. Who was that? Would you believe? But does she
really think she... And that's just six. Here in Santa Barbara County, there are eight local stations, and the listeners here can pick up something like 40 others from the greater Los Angeles area. But beware, not all of them are quite what they sound. Take this one, for instance.
You're with friends, and the music is non-stop here at WTW.
Now, that may sound warm, mellow, and personal. Would you believe all that is coming from a bunch of machines?
The WTW time is 14 minutes past 10.
It's country-style chicken time down on 13th and Vine. Y'all come now.
Well, the show may be going on, but apart from me, there's not a soul here. The jingles, the commercials, the music, the voices, they're all doing their own thing. There has been some form of automation in American broadcasting for at least the last two decades, but this equipment, currently on test for a genuine radio station in Pipestone, Minnesota, perhaps for the first time, combines all the advantages of automatic broadcasting with the freedom of a live program. Now, WTW is only on trial, so we can happily switch it off and just take stock of what we have got here. In this rack, there are several loops of magnetic tape. Now, these contain short segments of the program, perhaps the jingles, the commercials, the station IDs, whereas over here, we've got the longer pieces of music, the segments from the records, the voices of the DJs, and so on. Down here, we've got another machine. Listen.
4 minutes after 7 o'clock. 6 minutes after 7 o'clock.
So, when the DJ up here says,
the WTW time is,
he doesn't really need to know what the time is at all, because down here is the machine which says,
8 minutes after 7 o'clock.
Thank you very much. So, what we've got here is a large automatic mixer which takes all these various sound sources and marries them together to produce the program which the station wants to put out. It's controlled by a microprocessor in here. Now, that can handle 10,000 separate changes before it goes right back to the start of the cycle and starts again. So, let's get WTW back on the air and see if we can get used to this style of broadcasting. Now, the display tells me that it's source 12 playing at the moment. That's music on the reel-to-reel recorder. 10's coming up next. That's probably a commercial. And whilst this equipment is looking after the actual broadcasting, back in the sound studios, the program makers can condense days of programs into just a few minutes.
This is radio station WTW playing all the good music for you here in Santa Barbara. A beautiful day in Santa Barbara. You're listening to WTW, your music station on the South Coast.
In a typical hour, an American DJ talks for just 4 minutes. By recording all his introductions at one time, a day's programming can be finished in less than 50 minutes.
Warm, mellow sounds from WTW.
But maybe the best is yet to come. Armed with simply a transistor radio to monitor the station output, and this device, it's a touch-tone transmitter, any of the station's news reporters can get onto the air live from any telephone straight through the computer. The system will go something like this. I'll dial the computer from here. When I'm through, I'll identify myself using a secret code on this transmitter. The computer will acknowledge that it recognizes me by putting in my earpiece what the station has got on the air at the moment. When that finishes, I'm on. Let's give it a try. One dime. Eight.
3711. Through to the computer. Now my security number. The best kept secret in Southern California, this. It's got me. I've got the music, so I can switch my transistor off. Now wait for the cue. I'm on. We interrupt the music here on WTW to bring you news that at this moment, an estimated 8 million viewers of British television are watching the goings-on of your radio station, Coast to Coast. This is Michael Rodd in downtown Santa Barbara, returning you to the music. Cue. That did it.
Well, I've got to say, Mark, never have I been more relieved to see Michael Rodd appearing on our screens in the familiar and welcoming environment of some sort of mixing desk studio audio environment where we know he's most at home. Well, you know, it's certainly most.
It's where he's happiest. Where he's happiest. He's definitely in his element, isn't he?
Yeah.
It was a rich, wholesome, rewarding stew of a segment after the paltry, non-amusing booshes we've been forced to consume.
Absolutely, yeah. Rod's been allowed to go abroad properly to America.
I know, Russ. I'm so excited for him. I mean, he does not give the game away that he's absolutely chuffed to bits that he's anywhere. You know, the last time we saw him go anywhere, he was in, Runcorn or something like that?
Yeah. But he's managed to make all his way to, Pipestone, Minnesota?
No, he was in Santa Barbara.
Oh, was he?
Yeah, that's where, so the experiment was happening in Santa Barbara for a station in Pipestone, Minnesota.
Oh, I see. Oh, I thought the weather looked a bit too nice for Minnesota. I must have missed that bit. Oh, right. Cruising on, did a little, little drive and chat, listening to the radio. What's the first thing he opens with? Oh, yeah. Everything here is just that little bit bigger than it has to be. And that goes right from the warmth of the welcome, which is very Partridge, I think, when he says that. Through to the size of the gas bill.
Yeah. Because he's basically, it's a compliment, sort of. It's a backhanded compliment because he seems to be enjoying himself.
Yeah.
But that does beg the question that, you know, you definitely raised and I was thinking is, since when has petrol... We're assuming by gas, he's just trying to fit in. Yeah. Like, hey, I'm in the States. I'm going to use the lingua franca. Since when has petrol in the States ever been more expensive than it is here?
No, I don't...
Never.
If petrol was the same price... then it would be bigger in America because their cars have bigger engines.
Oh, huge. Yeah, absolutely, Jay. Having just been there, it is sickening how large their cars are. I mean, it's annoying. It's just, there is literally no need.
So I guess, I don't know. Maybe, I don't, is there any way of finding out the relative costs of petrol in Britain and America?
Oh, we'll have to ask some other podcasts to do it. I'm not sure. I'm not sure we have it in us anymore.
No.
It was a weird thing. He's right about the warmth, but yeah, he could have said anything. I mean, literally, he could have said absolutely anything.
Yeah, he could have said something about the food, petrol, like the food, for example.
Food.
That would have made much more sense, wouldn't it?
I still remember you laughing at me when we were in a family restaurant in New London, Connecticut, when I saw the size of the carbonara that I ordered. And you laughed at my face dropping because you knew that what I clocked was clearly so horrifically large. That I had lost all hunger and motivation. I just wanted to leave the country at that point. Yeah. That would have been an example. He could have easily talked about the food. And he'd be right. He literally picked the one and only example I can think of where he's wrong. That is so Rod. Hey, that's so Rod, isn't it?
This is one of those inventions where it's complete common sense, isn't it, really? I mean, it's one of those things where, of course, they've created pre-recorded things, and now computers have got to a level of cleverness now that you can tell a computer to run a radio station. So, there's a huge amount we could say about the invention itself, but I quite liked the... You know, the Roddisms throughout it. I liked him going to the payphone and having to to dial up the radio station in order to interrupt the broadcast. But he's got his own little special touch tone machine that he has to put to the receiver because obviously the payphone is still an analog dial. So it's
like an early remote control for a TV, isn't it?
Yeah. And then he says that the PIN number that he has to enter is the best kept secret in Southern California. And then we watch him enter the PIN number 1978 which is presumably when this was filmed. Because
Yeah. This is clearly last year's segment, isn't it?
Yeah. And then he gets to interrupt the transmission with his own little message there. And as you say, he puts on a slightly American twang, doesn't
there's
he?
There's a twang, isn't there? It's really sweet. Yeah. It's Rod is most adorable. And it made me, and I know you and I love to, we really do like Michael Rod, but like there's something about him that just inspires us to imagine his internal life.
Yes, definitely.
And I heard that bit and my response to you was like, it just made me think, I thought it was a small hint that perhaps he believes he might actually have the chops to break into the US market. Yeah. Not that he wants to,
no.
Just that he thinks he could if he tries. Yeah, really. That's the Michael Rod.
The option was always
there. Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, I could if I wanted. Yeah. But you know what? 8 million people watch me in Tomorrow's World. Yeah, so yeah. I think I'm okay, guys. I loved it.
Yeah, definitely. Totally. And also, we've got to say, the episode has been good for music, isn't it? And this is absolutely, you know, this is the
best. I literally up until a few weeks ago, when I was in the States, I was thinking, like, do you know what I should do? I should make a Spotify playlist of all the music on these episodes, because there's been some really good ones. This is the best episode. This is the best musical episode we have, because not just, you know, the Third Man theme, which like. Any other episode that would walk away with the title of the best use of song, but on this one there is banger after banger after banger.
Well, I mean, 1979, good era for music anyway. But we've got. He's initially listening to what's her name? If I Can't Have You, Yvonne Elliman.
By Yvonne Elliman. Yeah.
And then there's a load of songs that we don't recognise. When he's going through the radio station, he's pressing the buttons on his push button radio, and he says he listens to six. So I think he only listens to five.
BBC lies.
Yeah. There's one where some woman's just singing burgers, tacos, pizza pie.
Burgers, tacos, pizza pie. Yeah. I don't know what that is.
No.
Don't know if it's an ad. Don't know if it's a song. Could be either. Yeah. It's America.
I did try searching for those lyrics. I couldn't find anything. So I reckon it's probably an advert. But then we get Lay Down Sally by Eric Clapton when he's first there, and then that cuts to Night Fever by the Bee Gees, which I'd say takes up most of the rest of the segment. That pretty much plays out for the whole thing.
Yeah, it does. We hear basically the whole tune.
Yeah. Which I'm certainly not against, because I think that's an absolutely cracking tune. Did we, when we did that theatre thing, did we not use that as one of our warm up songs?
Yeah, I thought so. Yeah. You mean you don't remember the dance moves? It was more of a kind of a foot shuffle kind of line dancing thing, wasn't it?
Yeah. And then we finish off with Hotel California by the Eagles as we fade out at the end there.
Which in terms of driving trips, is pretty much top of the shop, isn't it, for a driving holiday?
Yeah.
Road trip. Yeah. Banger after banger after banger.
Big payday for the Gibb brothers as well, because not only Night Fever, but also If I Can't Have You is also
written by them
as well. Yeah. Well, it's not a big payday because the BBC obviously doesn't pay.
No, they have a flat fee.
Yeah.
Yeah. Famously, the BBC have a flat fee, which is why they use anything they want.
Well, which of those songs do you reckon is Rod's favourite?
Wow. Lay Down Sally?
Yeah.
I think, let's think this through. Go on. We don't have to include it in the episode, but it's like, I'm thinking, do you think he likes If I Can't Have You, Yvonne Elliman?
Well, that's got probably the most negative lyrics, which he obviously he likes.
Oh, true. He does like
a bit of heartache.
Misanthropic lyrics, Knife Fear I dismiss because I think it's a bit too disco-y.
It's a bit too confident, isn't it?
It's a bit too modern. Like, I think he needs something with a bit more soul. Hotel California, I think he'd think it's just too American. Which is why I was left with Lay Down Sally.
Yeah,
That was apparently I thought of that all in the space of a second and a half, and I just no. Yeah, so that's there you go. That's that. Well, would you agree?
And also I think he'd probably quite like Eric Clapton as a, you know.
Maybe not recently, but back then. He could have a bit like Breaking America as a broadcaster. I think he thinks he could have been in Creed. Or at least engineering for them.
Yeah.
Because that's the weird thing. It's like he is abroad and he is in the States. And I was pleasantly surprised he was as enthusiastic about the US as he seemed to be. Because in our first episode, which please don't ever listen to because it's nowhere near as good as they are now. It was from 1981. Yeah. And twice he was very patronizing and dismissive about the Americans. Mm. In fact, the title of the episode is called The Americans.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it was so obvious the way they dismissed them in two different segments, I think. Yeah, or was it just the nuclear one?
No, no.
But the thing is, we were also convinced, after that episode, we were convinced that we would probably see Tomorrow's World littered with patronizing, dismissive statements about Americans. And it hasn't really popped up. So the fact that 2 years or 3 years previously to that episode, he's over there and he seems to actually quite enjoy it, I was really surprised about. I would have expected him to kind of just find the whole thing gaudy, but maybe confronted with the reality of the fact that most Americans are actually really friendly and nice. Yeah. It's even difficult for someone as miserly with his enthusiasm to keep going, I suppose. I wondered if it was just because he met so many charming individuals that he just couldn't, you know, pretend that he wasn't enjoying it.
Yeah, that nameless man with the smooth
DJ,
smooth American DJ voice. Which reminded me of, do you remember Wayne's World when they had Handsome Dan? And it's actually, I think it's actually Harry Shearer, I think. But he's got that really smooth, voice. And then they see him and he's like really ugly.
That was fun.
Reminded me of that. But yeah, I was going to ask you, Mark, one thing that occurred to me, which is vaguely connected to this. Do you know why all American radio stations begin with W or K?
I don't know why it's W or K. Oh, well, I know one is W, I think, is all stations east of the Mississippi, I know, are W, because like W something or another was like Boston. Yeah. There's a famous radio station in Boston. WNPR, I think, does a lot of work with the BBC. And I know K was west of the Mississippi because like there's a famous LA, you know, Radio 6 music equivalent called KN. I don't know what they're called. Doesn't really matter. Why it was W and K, I don't know. Not least because was east as W. And
It's instantly confusing, isn't it? You'd think W at least be west, but...
Yeah.
So I also knew that fact about that.
Yeah, that's where I stopped.
So I thought, well, I wonder what's going on here. It turns out that just after the sinking of the Titanic in 1912, this is obviously when radio was starting to become, you know, big thing. And all the different countries in the world had their own radio stations and all this. And they realized that in order to reduce confusion and to ensure that everyone knew who everyone was talking to and all of this on the radios, they had this big conference that all of the countries that had radio came in London, all came to this conference in 1912. And they agreed sets of standards for radio. And one of the things they agreed was that that all radio stations would require a call sign, which would be a series of letters and numbers. And then they went, okay, right. So what we'll do is we'll divvy up the alphabet between all of the countries at this conference. And then they can then take those letters and use them to make call signs. So as soon as somebody said, this is W something, 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 people will know that's America or whatever. So Britain got the letters G, B and M. So all of the British call signs would begin with G, B or M. Germany got D, obviously with Deutschland. France got F. America, and I think this is probably the greatest fact of the entire episode, Mark. So we already know that America got W and K. Do you know what other two letters it also got?
U and S?
No. A and N.
Wank.
So I just wonder. And the thing is, right, bearing in mind that Britain got GB, right? And France got F. Germany got D, right? So they got their own...
Yeah.
America got W, A, N and K. And this conference being held in London. I just don't believe that...
They must have been giggling into their fists.
I don't believe that that was in any way a coincidence or a mistake. So America got those letters. Then obviously all the countries went home. And then only America, for whatever reason, decided to enforce this thing where their radio station... So the Federal Communications Commission insists that the broadcasters have to periodically announce what their call sign is. So that's why they all still call themselves by their, you know, WSRX or whatever, all that malarkey. There is a thing like these days, they've softened the regulations slightly, so they can choose, as long as they've got a W or a K in front, they can choose the rest of the letters. As long as nobody else has got those letters, they can have it. So there's a certain amount of personalization they can have. But the other thing the Federal Communication Commission requires is that all of their DJs have to get a license to ensure that they know how to run the station properly. Initially, this was a block to automation because there was always needed to be someone there. And the reason was this was because of the Cold War, because they needed somebody to be in the station at all times in order to announce stuff from the president. So they had like a special pink envelope that was delivered to the, all of the radio stations in America once a year that had instructions inside it. And if they ever got a thing from the president, they had to crack it open in order to announce it. So this is all stuff that only happened in America that we never had. So that's kind of, I thought that was kind of interesting. But there's kind of, obviously these days, there's a lot more technology. And now these days, the American government can just take over a radio station itself without there having to be a person there. So they've relaxed rules. And so, you can automate stuff a lot more these days, but obviously now it's just done with a computer, so it's not really much, not really, I can tell you the computer does it.
Okay, brilliant. To be honest, the actual stuff itself wasn't why this segment was fun. It was just Rod gallivanting around and being in his element, because once again, as you say, like he's an engineer in a studio, and instead of making a track, he's mixing a radio station.
yeah.
It's just a shame we didn't get a song from him, that's all.
That is true, yeah. When we do start our 24/7 Rod radio station,
yeah,
we can cut this announcement out and
splice it in.
It'll be like the DJ announcement between songs.
Yeah. I love it. It's going to be like the hospital radio station with the oil rig we build. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah.
One
final thing. I don't really notice the car that Roddy's driving there. Did you recognise it at all?
No, I didn't, but you did say make sure to ask me about Rod's car.
I got very excited when I saw the car.
Is it the same car that E.T.'s mum drives?
No, not even better than that, Mark.
Oh, okay.
Even better than that. Imagine, right?
Harry and the Hendersons.
Re-picture that car in your mind, but in like a sort of...
It's a state car, isn't it?
Yeah. Station wagon, as Americans call it.
Station wagon, yeah.
But re-picture it in your mind as a sort of like sandy brown colour with a big wooden stripe down the side.
National Lampoon's Vacation.
Lethal Weapon 2, Mark. It's
Trish's
car from Lethal Weapon 2.
Oh my God. Okay.
The one that the exploding toilet flies out the window and lands on. Yeah.
Wow. That's brilliant.
Yeah.
Oh, he's lucky to survive then, isn't he?
And that, Mark, is the limits of my knowledge about that episode. But I think we've run quite a lot out of that. Considering the raw materials we were given there, I think we managed to wring some sort of sense out of it.
I think you know, it's a testament to Rod, who's done a lot of heavy lifting for us by having the two, the start and the finish of the episode, as you said earlier, are the two best segments. And there's a lot of fun to be had there. Yeah. In the middle is, it's bleak, isn't it? It's bleak. Oh, it's, thank God we had each other, because I wouldn't want to take that journey alone. Yeah.
Do you think maybe after, obviously, Margaret Thatcher did a lot to try and reduce the power of the unions. Do you think it was after seeing this episode that she realised that the industrial action was anathema to decent tomorrow's world, and she needed to bring the unions down to prevent them from doing this ever again?
I hadn't thought of that, Russ. I had thought about the coincidence of Thatcher being in power as this episode was broadcast, but I did not think this might be the Rosetta Stone of understanding why she was so anti-union. Because, you know, my takeaway is like 45% pay cut. Join a union. A pay rise, rather. Join a union.
Yeah,
hers was like, we never need to see anything like this ever again.
Anyway.
Shall we?
Yep.
All right. Yeah, actually, speaking of Thatcher and the year, let's talk about the year in context. Let's start our audit with the cinema box office, Russell.
It's a beauty, Mark. It's a beauty.
So November 1979, 22nd of November 1979, isn't it? 29th of November. So let's go for it. So we're heading towards Christmas, so we shouldn't have any, I was about to say we shouldn't have any summer blockbusters. That's not true, because the bloody delay getting them over here means that, like, this might be what June is now. Anyway, go on. I'm excited.
Well, I would say, I think this is, we're still in the period of this, you know, that 70s period where basically all films are good, essentially. It's a top eight. Number eight, Moonraker.
So what a great example to start with, but with a list of films you maintain a good quality. All right, Moonraker, brilliant.
Moonraker, of course, is subject to one of the biggest ever mass hallucinations in cinematic history, where everyone thinks that so you know, in Moonraker, Jaws meets the little Swiss girl.
The girl.
And everyone thinks that Jaws smiles at her, and he's got big, he's obviously his metal teeth there, and she smiles back, and she's got braces. Which is obviously makes total sense.
Yes.
Doesn't happen. She hasn't got braces at all. No.
She just smiles back.
But everyone who's ever watched it thinks that they see braces on her. They don't. It's not.
I love that literally everyone in the world
could have polished that script better than it already was.
Yeah, but they didn't. Yeah.
Such a great script that everyone can give it a bit of a polish.
And to the point that everyone has mass hallucinated that polished script.
We've all decided we prefer to imagine a better film.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anyway, number 7, Alien.
Oh, okay, cool.
Number 6, The Bitch. Number
Bitch.
That's the old Joan Collins film, isn't it?
She's Joan Collins, yeah.
Number 5, Quadrophenia. Number 4, Yanks, which is a Richard Gere film. I'm not seeing that one. John Schlesinger. Number 3, Hooper. Classic Burt Reynolds stuntman film starring with Jan Michael Vincent from Airwolf. Top helicopter botherer. Number 2, Life of Brian. And number 1, Rocky 2.
Okay, that's a pretty decent list.
Yeah.
What about the pop chart?
There's some good ones here. Number 10, Knocked It Off by B.A. Robertson.
Okay. I'm always gobsmacked when I find out he's a real person and not just a swear word to throw around.
Number 9, Eton Rifles by The Jam. Number 8, Confusion / Last Train to London by Electric Light Orchestra. Number 7, One Step Beyond by Madness. Number 6, Complex by Gary Newman. Number 5, Walking on the Moon by The Police. Oh, that's something I only found out this week. You know, Sting,
yes,
at the beginning of Money for Nothing by Dire Straits, goes, I want my MTV, that bit.
Mm-hmm.
That's to the tune of Don't Stand So Close to Me. I'd never noticed.
Okay.
Noticed that. Anyway, number 4, Still by The Commodores. Number 3, No More Tears, Enough is Enough by Donna Summer and Barbara Streisand. Number 2, Crazy Little Thing Called Love by Queen. And number 1, When You're in Love with a Beautiful Woman by Dr. Hook.
Hey, that's a nice list. There are some good songs in there. Yeah. And if we had been earning £8,000 and we're now earning 11,000 and something, what could we buy? What are the prices?
Well, you can absolutely go to town, Mark. You could a gallon of petrol, 98 pence. Bottle of sherry, £2.34. Pint of beer, 46 pence. 20 smooth, delicious fags, 67 pence.
Oh.
Pint of milk, 15 pence. Loaf of bread, 25.5 pence. Daily Mirror, 8 pence. Average house, £20,000. So that means it only take 2 years for a technician to save up for a house, assuming they didn't spend any money, they neither eat or drink.
Yeah.
Can of Coke, 12 pence. Ford Cortina, $3,500. And half a dozen eggs, 22 pence.
Interesting. So you could basically, with your raise, you could go out and buy a Ford Cortina. Argos catalog?
Well, Mark, I think we may have had this one before.
Have we done 79 before? Maybe we have. Ooh, gosh.
It is the Russell Hobbs 3636 Futura automatic kettle. Spout filling with water level indicator cannot be switched on unless there is sufficient water covering the elements. Switches off when boiled. Safety cutout, 2,400 watts, capacity 3.5 litres. No, 3.5 pints, sorry. BEAB approved. Recommended retail price, £29.84. Argos price, £21.49.
Oh, look at that. Living the dream. Magazine covers.
New Scientist has a picture of a seal laying on a sandy beach. And all it says is, Hawaii, paradise lost, ? My friend Clara went to Hawaii recently for a work conference. And she said it was basically like Florida with lava and spam. She was not impressed by it at all.
I've always wanted to go.
Her hotel room that her bosses, obviously, the company paid for.
Mm.
She said it wasn't particularly nice. It was fairly nice. But it wasn't, you know, it wasn't top of the shop or anything. And it cost $1,600 a night.
What? Get out of town.
Yeah.
That is ridiculous.
Yeah.
And maybe I'll save a Hawaii trip for retirement or something.
Yeah. Scientific American.
Yeah.
Has a lovely picture of some dung beetles on it. And it says Ecology of the Dung Beetle.
Ooh.
Time Magazine.
It'll fly off the shelves. Yeah.
Time Magazine has it's a test of wills. And it has a large drawing of the Ayatollah Khomeini looking very sinister. And then on top of that... in same profile, but it's a photograph of Jimmy Carter looking much less sinister.
Okay, cool.
Interestingly, Khomeini, only 2 months later, was voted Time magazine's Man of the Year in January 1980.
Well, he achieved a lot, I suppose.
Private Eye has renamed itself Private Spy. Because just 2 weeks earlier, they'd unveiled that Anthony Blunt was the previously unnamed fourth member of the Cambridge spy ring. So on the front of their issue, it's got a picture of Anthony Blunt looking a bit miffed, and it says Blunt lashes out, and there's a black man next to Blunt saying, "I hear the Queen is terribly upset," and then it's got Anthony Blunt saying, "I most certainly am." Little homophobic joke there.
There we go. That dates that, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. To sometime younger than, no, older than 5 years ago or something. Yeah, okay.
And finally, Playboy has a woman who looks very much like a 1970s version of Pamela Anderson. Very similar looking face in some sort of floaty dress with her legs out. And Sex in the Cinema is the main headline. And then other articles inside are condominiums. That's such a weird word, condominiums, isn't it? How you are being sold out in the real estate market, and Norman Mailer's gripping study of Gary Gilmore. And you know Gary Gilmore, you know Gary Gilmore is Mark?
Is he in a band?
No. He's the person who murdered two people in Utah and then demanded that you get the death penalty.
Gosh, okay. And that sounds like an interesting story.
Because they hadn't, nobody been executed in the United States for 10 years. And he got his wish. He ended up getting executed.
Dreams do come true, don't they?
Yeah.
All right, well done. Well done, Gary. I think it's time to do the audit then, isn't it? It's a bit of a weird one, this, but we'll persist. Most important invention.
Well, it's either the rods, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. So, the photo fit style thing, then?
The helicopter thing isn't a bad invention.
No, that's true. It's just really
saves
boring.
A lot of lives.
Yeah, it's enabled helicopters to save a lot of lives. Mm. So yeah, all right. Well thought through. I think that works for me. Most worthless invention. Is it the bosun's ladder?
Yeah, it's got to be, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, do we need to think of anything else?
I mean, that rocket-powered train. That train that just fell apart. That was pretty ruthless.
Oh, that rod was driving. Yeah. Yeah, that's true. The clown car train. Do you want to go with both those? Yeah. Most inaccurate prediction of the future.
Rod saying that monorail didn't work or whatever it was, he said.
Yeah, too complicated when actually it was
roaring
perfectly fine and
been running for
roaring success.
Nearly 50 years now.
Yeah, it's everywhere. Yeah, that's a good one. Worst screw up by a presenter? I really did not like seeing Judith pick things up in a pretty dangerous way. But I suppose she was trying to make a point.
Yeah.
Obviously, Kieran attempting to climb the mast. That was, you know, which he, to the best of our knowledge, were enough of the fact that we've seen later episodes, he could still be up there.
All right.
All right, we go with those. Best attempt at making something boring interesting. Well, I mean, is this exactly what this, is the helicopter segment exactly what this category is? Like, it is, you know, incredibly exciting until they start talking about something incredibly boring.
Yeah. It's got to be, isn't it?
It has to be, doesn't it? Yeah. And that's literally, you know, it's a classic kind of sandwich, isn't it? Where it's like full action scenes and really dull bit in the middle where it has to look at different graphs. Yeah. Best use of music.
Whoa.
See, I think I would still go for
the third man because
it's used in the segment. Having said that, the music used in the last segment is brilliant road trip music. Mm. And he is on a road trip. He's driving along the street, you know, the roads around Santa Barbara. But I still think I'd earn... I think it's a great way of opening the program.
Third man, he plays more of a role in the...
Yeah.
What's going on?
No, but obviously, you know, in the third man, you know, the main character is in Vienna and he's looking to track down his friend Harry Lime, who's a criminal. Mm. So he is on the lookout. He's looking around. I don't remember there being a gnome. I don't remember him stopping outside Interflora, but yeah. So I thought that worked quite well. And it's just such a jaunty tune.
Yeah, it is. Enjoyed that. Yeah.
And it's a shame because, like, you know, otherwise, you know, Night Fever, Hotel California, you could have quite easily won just by being a great tune, nicely placed. But best or worst use of furniture?
Oh, I always forget this one. Oh, it's got to be. I don't know. I don't know whether does a drawing board count as furniture? Is turning a drawing board into a computer?
Oh, I don't know.
Biros and paper. I don't know. That's quite impressive.
Because the only thing I could think of was the bosun's chair. But you are right. We do see that lovely kind of not angle poise, but that, you know, that angled table, that kind of architect's table. Is that a good? Yeah, why not? Yeah, hey, Russ, we've made this up. We can say whatever we want. Yes, it's winning. Most notable clothing.
Well,
can I put this just immediately, just a quick shout out for the stranger's cravat? That would be where I'd be describing him first.
I was thinking immediately popped in my mind was the Russian with the Russian's hat.
Oh yeah, yeah, the Cossack hat thing or whatever it is. Yeah.
I feel like it's got to be one of those people, either him or the Jacques Cousteau person, or
the pipe and the hat combination. Yeah.
Ooh.
What else did we have? Yeah,
there was Judith's flight suit. Her double denim number later on, when you see her midriff.
Yeah.
She's wearing like a denim shirt and jeans. I have to say, a nice shout out. Kieran was wearing a nice kind of jumper when he was on the boat. He did look like he fitted in until he started climbing. It's quite a lot of clothes. What's notable, though? It's got to be the Cossack hat.
I think it's got to be
the cravat or the Cossack hat. So I'm going to go with the Cossack hat. Because like the stranger was deliberately set up to be a bit of a character, whereas that was a real man on the streets of Cambridge. Yeah. It's not the maddest market hat we've seen by any stretch of the imagination. That was the Adebisi number in Shepherd's Bush. But that's pretty mad. Did we see anything in the episode that made it through to the future?
Well, yep.
That's a big yes, isn't it?
No, absolutely. Yeah. Or with it, basically.
Yeah. Well, you'd hope it would be, bearing in mind they have culled previous segments. I'd like to think they wouldn't pick one that was clearly nonsense. Mm. I mean, having said that, even the majority of the monorail solutions that Rod trashes, they all made it through. Like they all exist and still in use. So it's like, it's pretty much everything, yeah, isn't it?
I think so.
Yeah. Okay, cool. Yeah. What does the episode tell us about 29th of November 1979?
Everyone's on strike.
It was a ripe period of industrial action. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Everyone's on strike, but it's great music.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, and it's very much, I would say, Michael Rodd is at the height of his powers. He completely rescued this episode.
Oh, he's a saviour. Yeah, because this would have gone nowhere fast. Not normally something you would say about segments involving either Judith or Kieran, but yeah, Rod is normally he's our hero, but this time he's a superstar.
Mm, mm.
Yeah. Let's look at the tropes for us, including the brand new one we've added. Presenter having to speak over louder sounds.
Judith in the helicopter.
Helicopter. Oh, great. Because even though she's wearing a microphone, I think I agree with that. Stanley Kubrick reference, and I had one of these for a while. Well,
the only thing I said is that
there's a loose connection, but not a reference. Mm. Yeah. Something to do with oil rigs.
Well, once again, there's a loose connection, but
loose connection. Not an actual reference. But no. Suspiciously obvious brand name and the ad-free BBC.
Interflora was the one that I saw.
You're damn right.
Incidentally, that Interflora place was selling Dutch windmill flower arrangements behind.
I saw that. I assume that was a nod to you, Russ.
Yeah, well, I was assuming these things are.
I know you do. clear and blatant lying. Oh, that's a big yes, isn't it?
Rod is absolutely...
from the photos onwards, yeah.
Spewing nonsense.
No evil farmers.
No.
But there's lashings of casual sexism.
Yeah, plenty. Yeah.
Plenty.
Yeah.
From all over the place.
From Judith herself.
It's been richly ladled from all four corners of this show. Also, I don't believe there were any Dutch angles.
Apart from those windmill flower arrangements.
Very true, but the camera was rock steady and on the level. There were no real dad jokes from Howard Stapleford or a Howard Stapleford equivalent that I can think of. Actually, even Kieran didn't kind of throw too many kind of
puns. It looked like it might be one of his earliest appearances. He looked very young.
I did say he looked fresh-faced and young. Yeah. Not that he looks older, looks old later on, but he definitely looked young. Episode ends in a damp squib?
No. I would say that, I mean, absolutely.
Any episode that fades out on Hotel California.
Yeah, I would say probably.
Segments.
Rescues. That end segment actually rescues the episode.
Rescues the entire, yeah, you're absolutely right. Yeah, so it's completely opposite. Lasers, question mark?
No.
Magnets, question mark?
Yes, magnetic levitating trains.
And boats, question mark?
Oh, yes.
Boats are plenty. Yeah, brilliant. So there's actually not a lot of hits in this one, but hits on the tropes thing, but there you go. So that's it. That's that episode. That's the parts bin special we've all longed to see.
A Frankenstein of an episode.
Frankenstein's monster. Yes, indeed.
I suppose we are rapidly approaching Halloween, so that...
You're right, Russ. Yeah, it was definitely spooky, wasn't it?
Yeah, we'll have to think of something particularly spooky to our next episode. So, Mark, before we go, can I just get a quick check on how many episodes we have left?
That's exciting. Well, Russell, that was our 22nd episode. And previously, as you know, we understood there to be a mere 1,400, but I have...
I've incredibly exciting news. And I know some people will already be aware of this, but thanks to Mark Gibbings Jones, he's also known as @BrokenTV on Twitter. He's one of those incredible must-follow tweeters. He is doing this incredible project at the moment where he is, I mean, no one asked him to do it. He's just doing it off his own back. And I think it's God's work. He's decided he's going to work out the 100 most broadcast episodes on BBC One and BBC Two and their equivalents of all time up until the end of last year. And he's been worked diligently. I think he was planning to have it done and dusted by the time the BBC celebrates its 100th birthday, which is, what, a few days time?
Yeah.
He hasn't quite got there yet, because it turns out there's a lot of work you have to do to work it. And I'm going to put a punt down here, and I'm assuming Holmes Under the Hammer wins. So it's not the program with the most episodes, the most broadcast, so that includes repeats. And because his work was so diligent, I've been waiting for him to reveal the true number of Tomorrow's World episodes.
Mm.
And he has done it. And I am excited to say, Russell, that there aren't 1,400 episodes. There are 1,409 episodes of Tomorrow's World, Russell, which means that we still have another 1,384 to go before we can rest in our graves. So thank you, Mark. That was, he actually shared with us the database of all his calculations, and I'm excited for us to use that, because I know we'll use it at some point. There'll be a reason we will want to go through that. So really grateful for that, and exciting that we have 9 more episodes than we ever dreamed possible, Russ.
That is, I mean, that's another, well, if we continue at our rate of 1 a month, that's another 9 more months, Mark, on top of 120 years or so that we
I think we worked out it was 2130 something, but no, 2140 something by the time we can finish this damn thing. But you know, at least we have something to hold out for. I mean, some people would produce a child in that time, but we'll produce 9 quality episodes, and I don't want to even think about how many hours it's going to take us to record. No, so that was brilliant news, and we're very grateful for Mark. And
yes,
do you follow him or read his blog? It's absolutely brilliant. He's also been doing something recent I've really enjoyed, which is he's been using all these AI art generating algorithms and programs, and he's been pumping them with the headlines from the day to day to see what they come up with, and to finally work out which of these art creation things is the best. So that's also been chef's kiss.
Wonderful. Okay, cool. Well, Mark, I've got to say, I am absolutely ravenously hungry. As I said earlier, I didn't have any lunch. It's now dinner time. Luckily, it is Sunday, Mark, so I'll be able to make myself a lovely, delicious Sunday roast dinner. But obviously, I will be very careful when lifting the potatoes to
of course you will,
into the oven. Don't want to put my back out. But so lovely to see you again. And I think we'll probably try and record another one quite quickly this time.
Absolutely. So, I was away for 3 weeks. Yeah. You were away for 3 weeks in summer where basically we basically have nothing to do now until Christmas. So I mean, we've got no excuse.
So if you didn't really enjoy this one, don't worry. It won't be long till the next episode.
Imagine listening to all this and getting to the end again. I didn't enjoy that.
That's it from us. So I'll say goodbye, and until next time, if you are on the internet, we will see you tomorrow.
Bye.